KUSK-TV is currently having audio problems. No adjustment of your set is necessary. Please stand by. KUSK-TV is currently having audio problems. No adjustment of your set is necessary. Please stand by. KUSK-TV is currently having audio problems. No adjustment of your set is necessary. Please stand by.
Averaging, I think, right around 35 times. So, you know, for us, we're a little more balanced than that. But I see their run stats, and the run stats are still good. Their total offense is awesome when you look at what you have to do to stop them. We'll have to control the ball. We'll have to be able to hold on to the ball our fair share. They've had the ball against their opponents about 6 minutes a game more, and we have to make sure that we have the ball our fair share.
Interesting that Coach Makovic would say we need to get the ball our fair share. My question is, when has football, or any other competitive sport for that matter, ever been fair? I think what Coach Makovic is saying, and we all understand this, is that we're going to have to earn our fair share of minutes. Time of possession, Washington State holds the ball almost 9 minutes longer than their opponent. Key statistic for Arizona, key thing to watch, third down conversion. Arizona is only mediocre at best, about 32% conversion. Washington State clips along at 42%. So we'll see if Arizona can indeed hold the ball long enough to make a difference in the end. Back upstairs.
Thank you very much, Mr. Cooper. We're looking forward to hearing from you tonight. Well, this guy now is the Dean of the Pacific 10 Conference Coaches. He's been at Washington State since 1989. Boy, I tell you Bud, about him. He's got so much Cougar blood in him. More about that later. How about the last 4 years? You thought I was kidding. 271 points. Not basketball, football. Four overtimes. And these two teams have made the theater of the absurd something usual. As you take a look down on the field now, that's Adam Holliday. He will kick the ball away to Arizona. The Wildcats on this blustery evening will be headed south to begin the game. And you saw just a moment ago the Wildcat receiving team on the field. That's a Cougars 3-0 coming in with their victory so far with a common opponent. And that was Idaho, the Wildcats as well. And both teams now set, ready to go. Here's Holliday. And we are underway from Arizona Stadium. Gary Love settles under this one and lets it trickle out the back of the end zone. And the Wildcats will have it first and 10 at their own 20. Arizona came up with an 11-played, 61-yard drive to score on their first series last week against UNLV for the first time this year. Let's have a look at the Arizona offense right now. And we begin at quarterback, Jason Johnson. There you see how consistent he is. He's accounting for about 240 yards per game, and he does that every game. Kratis, Sampe, Grace, Barry, and Safranik, the offensive line that's been together all year. Farmer, Detweiler, Wade, Leonard, and Hugo with him. On first down, the pitch is outside. It's complete, and already we've seen our first sparkler. And Arizona close to a first down. As we take a look at the Cougars defensively, Washington State, the number one run defenders in the Pac-10, ranking well nationally. That's Tuupo, Long, Tupai, and Shavies across the front. And the secondary in just a sec. On second down and very short. The give is straight ahead and just scrambling far enough for the first down is Leo Mills. Or make that Clarence Farmer. Farmer with the first down for Arizona, and the Wildcats move the chains for the first time. Clarence comes in, averaging about 81 yards per game, and he didn't play that much last week against UNLV.
Well, I don't think Arizona's going to waste much time testing this defense, which finished in the bottom of the Pac-10 last year in scoring defense and total defense.
On first down, Johnson straight through the middle, and it's picked off. And this one's coming back a long way. Down to the 10 and in for the touchdown on the reverse of fortunes. It's Lamont Thompson, a free safety. And for Thompson, that is his second interception of the year. And he puts the Cougars on the scoreboard.
Well, Thompson is a very opportunistic player. He already has the school record for interceptions at Washington State, that being his 16th. This is very unlike Jason Johnson. He throws the ball in a lot of traffic on a crossing route. Thompson, give him credit, steps up perfectly just as the ball is arriving and accelerates into the end zone.
And it appeared that he was looking for Anthony Fulcher out of the backfield across the middle. Here is the conversion. It is straight down the middle. And the Cougars have taken the lead on Thompson's return of an interception for a touchdown. So Lamont Thompson and the Cougars on top of the Wildcats, 7-0. Well, Lamont Thompson and the Cougars on top. Lamont missed last year with a neck injury, but he did not miss an opportunity just a moment ago, as for the second time this season, Jason Johnson is intercepted. And Doug, I tell you what, it was dangerous territory to throw that football.
That is why many times you'll see interceptions on short yardage situations and also near the goal line. The quarterback does not look at the entire field. That time, Jason Johnson, he focused on his primary receiver and never saw Thompson jump in front of that route.
Well, as we mentioned, just the second interception of the season. That's through the first 12 quarters. This is quarter number 13 for Jason. As I mentioned, Thompson missed all of last year. Took a year off. Youngster out of El Cerrito, California. And he gives the Cougars a lead, 7-0. So just as we saw a moment ago, Adam Holliday is on the field. Feeling a bit more festive this time, yeah, with a lead to this.
Yeah, Washington State's trying to return the favor of last year when the Arizona defense converted on 5 turnovers against this Washington State Cougar team.
This one may be returned. Love says no. Andre Thurman said you better hang on in the end zone, and Arizona will start at the 20 again. Well, this is a talented Washington State defense. We said coming in, we met the defensive linemen. Let's take a look at the linebackers. That's James Price, no relation. Trefont Thompson. Now, Trefont may not be seen tonight. Newman and David. First down, Arizona at their own 20. Give it to Farmer, round left tackle. He's in the backfield of Washington State. And Doug, that's exactly what Arizona needs to do tonight, carve up some yardage on the ground. First down for the Wildcats.
The Farmer came into tonight's game averaging 5 yards per carry. But don't forget, this Washington State team is leading the Pac-10, only allowing 66 yards. But it's pretty easy to run through holes that are that big.
And you saw that number 19 loom large again. It was Lamont Thompson who made the tackle on Farmer. Otherwise, he may have gone further south. Single back on first down. Give it straight ahead once again. And straight into the line, it was Tremaine Cox this time. You might recall Tremaine last week with an 80-yard scamper against the Running Rebels.
And Cox is currently averaging 8 yards a carry based on that 80-yard run that he had last week. But he's been a nice surprise for this offense. He's a nice addition to rotate those running backs in that backfield position.
Right, Tremaine in the shuttle system in the backfield with Arizona. But Johnson off the tee, single back, second down and 5. Give it to Farmer, and Farmer may be very close to another first down. They're going to mark him down at the 40. Should come up to be third down and 1. And once again, it was Thompson with the tackle. And I know you like busy defensive backs.
When you're a safety, though, you do not want to lead your team in tackles. That is not a good sign, because that means the linebackers and linemen are letting those guys through. I like what Arizona is doing on the offensive line right now. They're zone blocking, allowing their running back to pick the holes.
Give it to Farmer again. That time, the Washington State front four collapsed on the line, and Farmer went nowhere. And we'll see if Arizona will send the punt unit on here with a fourth down and a couple of inches. And you'd figure they would. It's too early. They're down by 7. And Ramey Peru leads the punt team onto the field. Well, Doug, we knew going in that was a very tough run defense the Washington State brought to Tucson. They showed their mettle on that play. And, of course, Coach Makovic discussing perhaps hole selection. Peru, this is his 12th punt. They'll make that the 17th punt of the year. And he fires a low line drive, and that comes down at the 15-yard line, taken by the Cougars. And still on his way back. And that was Colin Henderson who brought it back for Washington State. Well, for the first time tonight, although they're leading by 7, we'll take a look at the Washington State starting group. And that begins with Jason Gesser. Got off to a great start as a freshman. Then he blew his thumb out against Arizona. And look at this year already. 10 touchdowns, 930 yards. The guy's blocking for him. Parrish Larkin.
KUSK-TV is currently having audio problems. No adjustment of your set is necessary. Please stand by.
Story. Not really a kid. He's a former United States Marine, married with a couple of kids, and majoring in biomechanical studies. And there you see him out of Stonington, Connecticut, played some of his junior college ball out in the West, and he's been at Washington State now. This is his senior year. He's co-captain of the Cougars.
Yeah, he's getting better every week, too. Last week was his fifth 100-yard rushing game.
7-0 Cougars, and they're knocking again. They go right back to Minnick, and the Wildcats were waiting for him. Lance Briggs, who leads Arizona with tackles, he had 26, burst through again.
Lance Briggs has got great acceleration and made a nice play.
All right, Uku, Frazier, Thompson, and Jackson, Wells, Briggs, Sealfili. And the defensive backs, Jolivet, Worcester, Nash, and Chapman for Arizona. And they've got their work cut out for them now. It's third down and 3 to go for the Cougars. The ball at the 20-yard line. They're showing stunt, and they bring him from behind, but they go right down the middle, and that's connected to their slot back. That's Nakoa McElreth, and he is the leading receiver in the country. Great story out of Scripps Ranch High School in La Jolla, California. And he had three touchdowns against the Cats in this building last year.
Well, he already has seven touchdowns on the season. And notice how he's able to slip between defenders. Not only is a good man-on-man receiver, but he also recognizes zone coverages and finds the slots.
Well, Gesser has the Wildcats guessing. They've got a single back in the backfield with a first down and goal. Ball at the 8-yard line. Gesser very quickly goes out, and Joel Avent almost got the tip. Incomplete pass brings up second down and goal.
Well, you're not going to find a more opportunistic player than Michael Joel Avent. Last week, he picked up a fumble and returned it for a touchdown, but he always knows where the ball is at in the air. They see the ball is tipped. You see Michael Joel Avent at the bottom of the screen. He manages to get a couple fingertips on it. But that would have been one heck of a catch had he been able to dive and gain possession of that ball.
All right. Second down and goal, and a timeout is called on Washington State. So the Cougars and Mike Price say, hey, this is a great opportunity. Let's make double sure. With the score, Washington State 7, Arizona nothing. 9:23 to go in the first quarter. We'll be right back. Well, John Makovic now being baptized in this unusual series. His quarterback, who'd been so steady to start the season, tosses an interception to begin the game. And now his defense has to step up as it is second down and goal for Washington State. The ball on the 8-yard line. Gesser, who is 2-for-3 passing tonight, has the backfield shift. Minnick, the lone setback. Long count on second down. They're going to give to Minnick. Off the left side, he's in. Touchdown, Washington State. And I'll tell you what, Doug, this is exactly what the Wildcats, and in particular John Makovic, did not want to see.
When you watch this offense perform, it is not a conventional offense. They have motion going in both directions every single play. You notice on the deep pass that was thrown earlier in the game goes off a play action, but notice here, this time he actually hands the football off. The Minnick breaking out to the outside, but they have this Arizona defense off guard at this time in the game.
And the conversion is right down the middle. Drew Dunning is 2-for-2, and that Dave Minnick enjoying his post-Marine life at Washington State University. Five times he has rushed for over 100 yards in his now two-year career at Washington State, and most recently he did it against Idaho.
What's not very often, you'll see a wide receiver, Mike Bush, that time, number 5, come down and be able to lead the process for David Minnick into the end zone. Most times receivers want to just try to avoid defensive backs and linebackers, but the running game is an entire effort. It involves the wide receivers as well as the linemen.
Well, Doug, you see there, it took him 6 plays, 76 yards, just 2 minutes and 5 seconds. And these Washington State Cougars are now way out in front of the Wildcats, 14-0, and Arizona now needs to get their offense cooking in a hurry. Hey, folks, the pennant race is red hot, and the Diamondbacks will try to move one step closer to the playoffs tomorrow afternoon against the Dodgers. Catch all the action live from Bank One Ballpark right here on Southern Arizona Sports Leader. Game time is 1:30 on Arizona's WB58 Cable 8. The kickoff, an onside attempt, and I think the Cougars may have got it. That's what they're saying. And it's the guy with the black and white shirt who says, indeed, Ira Davis, a running back, number 12, comes up with the football for Washington State, and the natives in this building are restless.
Washington State came with all the tricks that they possibly had. You could tell they had their game face on. They were deadly serious before this game began. And I think just looking at the play selection, excellent execution that time by their kicker in being able to keep that ball alive. Not very often you'll see a kicker fighting for the football.
And you can see number 4, Adam Holliday. He's a kicker, and he was not afraid to stick his head in the middle of it. 6'3", 230-pound junior kicker. He helps the Cougars get the ball back. Gesser wide out quickly to Bush, and Bush is swarmed and taken down immediately. Brandon Nash, amongst others. The Wildcats now are going to be hopping mad, I can tell you that. As Bush took that pitch right outside, and Arizona's secondary was right on top of him.
If the Wildcats weren't ready to play at the beginning of the game, they are now. You could just see the composure that defense has right now and the determination. But credit Washington State. They run a very quick tempo offense. Three-step drops, play action on the deep passes.
Nicole McElrath on second down. Gesser fires out into the flat, and it's complete again, and it's Bush again. Mike Bush now has 13 catches this year at Meridian High School in Riverside, California. He was outstanding at basketball, football, and rugby, all three.
What makes their offense so effective also is their receiving core as well as their quarterback. Bush, we talked about the size he has earlier, but he also has great leaping ability. In high school, he played track. Notice the sharp route that he ran there, coming to the inside and then turning and quickly turning to the outside, and the ball was there.
Well, he has a chance to wreck Arizona in two sports now. Gesser with a deep drop. And here's the screen to Minnick. Minnick straight down the sideline. He's headed for the end zone. Touchdown, Washington State. And would you believe, with 8 minutes and fewer in the first quarter, the Wildcats are now trailing 20-0.
One of the ways to try to offset an aggressive defense is with misdirection and screens. And Washington State has been successful on both of those areas tonight. Perfectly executed screen. The quarterback is the one that makes this work. He sells it to the defense that it's going to be a pass play. And notice the linemen downfield. Even if they don't get a block, they provide a running lane.
Dunning for the third time in a very short period of time hits the conversion, and we have a timeout. 8 minutes, 8 seconds remain in the first quarter, and somehow the Washington State Cougars have stunned the Wildcats already. They lead 21-0. Hey, do you know what your date's really thinking? May not be what you'd expect. Blind Date, weeknights at 9 on Arizona's WB58 Cable 8. They're not worrying about their dates tonight. They're worrying about Arizona right now. The Wildcat fans stunned. It's 21-0 in favor of the Cougars. And Adam Holliday kicks off for Washington State. And just like he has before, he nails this one. 7 yards beyond the dead ball line. And here come the Wildcats again from the 20-yard line. Dave Minnick with that scoring drive just a moment ago. And he did it again on the screenplay, Doug.
And this call was well executed. Dave Minnick followed his blockers perfectly down the field. You'll see that he was patient. He did not try to outrun his blockers. He allowed them to go ahead and execute their blocks and then ran right down to that running lane.
Well, Minnick scored a touchdown for him. So has Lamont Thompson on interception. Minnick has 2 touchdowns, as a matter of fact, as Johnson on first down, play action fake, stays in the pocket, wobbles it across the middle, and that one's picked off. That one's going the other way as well. James Price with the interception for Washington State. And, Doug, I've not seen anything like it.
James Price was in the right place at the right time. It looked as though that ball was deflected at the line of scrimmage. Again, Jason Johnson was eyeing his primary receiver, and I believe it allowed their defensive linemen to get into the passing lane, get their hands up, and I believe if we see a replay on that, then we will have a deflection at the line of scrimmage. You can see the bar.
That's Jeremy Williams, number 95. There's Williams, 95, big paw up. Wobbled it just enough.
That's 2 consecutive passes now that have gone for interceptions and put Arizona deep in their own territory.
The first interception of the year for James Price gives Washington State outstanding field position. First and goal. Gesser looking for a 4th touchdown, and he goes a little bit too tall. One of his favorite receivers in the pattern that time, and that was Nicola McElrath. And that is an understatement. He had 163 yards in receiving yardage last week against Cal in the Cougars league opener. And Washington State now, boy, I tell you what, it's almost unthinkable, but they could be up on top of the Wildcats 28-0 still in the first quarter. Gesser now 5 of 7 passing tonight. Single setback is Minnick behind him on 2nd and goal. They give it to Minnick, and the Wildcat line stands him up and takes him back out to the 10-yard line. And we'll see about the how they allow for forward progress. They had a little chat going on. It wasn't exactly Semper Fi, they were saying out there.
Well, David Minnick, don't think of him as just some beer-drinking Marine that just showed up here to play at Washington State. This guy has some talent. He ran 4.5 seconds in the 40-yard dash, which is extremely fast for a running back, clocked by a lot of pro scouts. And this guy has determination. When he gets the football, he is not going to allow one defender to bring him on the ground.
Well, they gave him a couple of yards on the rush. It's now third down and goal from the 6-yard line. Three wide receivers to the near sideline. Gesser fires out quickly, and that is caught, and that is a touchdown, and that is Mike Bush. Bush with yet another reception. That is three tonight. And how about the Cougars? They have come in and absolutely stunned,
Mike Bush,
perplexed the Wildcats.
I would say I have never seen this Washington State team play with such urgency. They are playing this entire game like it's a two-minute drill, and their goal is to get into the end zone. Mike Bush knows that he's going to make a tough hit, but he still makes the catch.
And Drew Dunning adds the extra point. And you run out of ways to describe the situation. 6 minutes, 57 seconds remain in the first quarter, and the Washington State Cougars have come in and absolutely thrown a curve at Arizona. They lead it 28-0.
You know, I would be very surprised not to see the same play selection continue throughout this game. Washington State has shown no mercy for any of its opponents. Last week against Cal, scoring 51 points.
Well, maybe Dana Cooper's got it figured out. Dana, down on the sidelines, what can you tell us?
They've got nothing figured out, but I recall a moment here in Arizona Stadium back in 1992. Dick Tomey, of course, was coach. Stanford came in here and went up 21-0 on the Cats in the first quarter. Coach Tomey blew a timeout. He gathered his entire team on the huddle, or on the sideline, and said, guys, it's no shame, it's no crime to be behind in a game, but the way we're behind is a crime. It's all about pride. It's all about determination. And you can bet that new coach John Makovic is repeating that speech, probably verbatim, right now.
Well, we'll see if it has a similar effect. The kickoff by Adam Holliday, effective again. And it was Gary Love who took the ball in the end zone. Arizona will once again begin at the 20-yard line, and that is as good a starting field position as they have had tonight.
Another weapon for this Washington State team is their kicker, Adam Holliday, like you were talking about, Dave. He's somebody that's going to neutralize any type of talent you have back there to return kickoffs, because this guy can consistently kick it into the end zone.
Johnson and company, first down, trailing by 28 points. Lots of time in the first quarter still. Johnson throws again, and that one is caught. Threw it out in the flat, and it's Bobby Wade, who comes up with his 15th reception of the season. Arizona has a first down, and they're across the 30-yard line.
I like that call because it puts the receiver in a position where he's on the outside. This time, Bobby Wade, one-on-one against any defensive back, is a mismatch. You'll notice how he's able to turn the defender and then stop and come back for the football. Well-thrown ball.
First down for the Wildcats. Johnson with a chat now to the backfield, where he goes, gives it to Farmer straight ahead. The Cougars and that outstanding defense caught him at the line of scrimmage. Bill Dova, the longtime defensive coordinator, he hired on at Washington State in 1989. And we've seen some very good defensive fronts come in for Washington State in years gone by.
Don't be surprised to see this Arizona offense attack number 27, Eric Coleman, from the Cougars defense. He's replacing their all-star Marcus Trufant, who is out with a knee injury, and expect them to continually try to go for that matchup.
Second down out of the shotgun. Good protection this time. Johnson with time goes right across the middle. That time it was away. That was Andre Thurman. Thurman caught the ball for enough yardage for the first down. Got whacked back 3 or 4 yards, but make no mistake about it. Arizona will have a first down at the 45-yard line.
And this has to be very frustrating for the Arizona offense, because they haven't had much of an opportunity to get out and prove what they can do, especially the receiving core. The receivers are starting to step up and make plays right now, but those two previous plays that were intercepted, the receiving core had nothing to do with it.
First down at the 45, a quick out pattern, and it's caught. That's by Brandon Marshall. Marshall does what the Wildcats want to see most. He makes something happen after the catch, and he gives Arizona another first down.
And we saw Brandon Marshall make some big plays in the pass. He's got the acceleration to get down the field, but their defense is laying off the receivers. They're allowing them these short and intermediate routes, and now it's going to be up to the receiving corps to make the big plays after the catch.
And it was Lamont Thompson who made the stop from his free safety position for Washington State. Trips to the near side, quick out, and this once again goes to Thurman. Thurman with some space, and he's close to the 30-yard line and still battling. And he will be marked down at the 31-yard line. Another first down for Arizona. And, Doug, I would say the Wildcats' attention has been garnered.
Taking nothing away from the Arizona offense, it's just the fact that they turned the ball over. They've put themselves in this position 28-0. They allow turnovers deep in their own territory. But you'll see the receivers also trying to pitch in and help out when one of the other receivers makes a catch. And this is they're not going to go down easy.
Johnson with the pitch. And this is Farmer looking for the left side, directs his blocker, stays on his feet, cuts back, and he's in open territory. One man to beat, and he will. Farmer in for the touchdown, Arizona. Something finally to cheer about.
Clarence Farmer does it all. He loves to cut back across the grain. Look at the move that he did there in escaping one of the Cougar defenders. And basically, he's making people miss without even being able to put a hand on him. And that was a nice move at the end just to basically leap over top of one of the defenders to get into the end zone.
Well, for Farmer, that is his fourth touchdown of the season. It couldn't come a moment sooner. Arizona on the scoreboard. And Sean Keel on to attempt the conversion to make it 28-7. He does. Well, Doug, we said kind of in jest you might see 100 points tonight. Well, how about 35 with 4:43 remaining in the first quarter?
Well, these guys are going to be wearing out the grass in the end zone. McLarence Farmer shows how you're supposed to do it as a running back. Great peripheral vision. He understands where all the defenders are at and anticipates their tackles before they get there.
And if we watch that replay one more time, in the Washington State defensive backfield was a kid wearing number 10. Yep, Jason Johnson. He was throwing blocks downfield as well.
Well, the offense, as I said, you have to involve both the quarterback downfield. This guy wants to try to get this thing turned around. We pointed out some of the receivers that already threw blocks, but
let's take one more look. Look at number 10. There's the quarterback, and he's going to get a piece of this, too.
Well, that looked like a quarterback block. That's where you make it look like you're going to block, but you really don't hit anything.
It's a hallmark deal. It's the thought that counts, and it's a good play. And that makes him feel a little bit better, as now the kickoff team is finally back on the field. Ryan Slack will kick for Arizona. He's kicking into a slight breeze, which is swirled around the stadium, so he goes low with this one. And it's going to be fielded at the 8 in bobble. However, that might open up a seam, and the return man in that instance was Jason David, a cornerback, who fielded the ball for Washington State. And the Cougars go to work now at the 24-yard line, first and 10, Washington State. So 35 points, folks, and still 4 minutes and 34 seconds remain in the first quarter. So have plenty of cold beverages ready in the refrigerator. We're going to be with you for a while.
Yeah, those are pretty impressive statistics. Look at that completion percentage already early in the game and those two touchdowns. But those are turnovers by the defense that put him in a position to obtain those statistics.
Gesser on first down, toss sweep. That's Dominick. He's caught in the backfield and swarmed for a loss of 1 yard. You took a look at those gaudy passing statistics a moment ago for Gesser. All of Mr. Johnson's pitches tonight, Jason Johnson's pitches. Let's take one more look at this first. As Minnick is swirled and down to the grass. But you take a look at Jason Johnson. He has thrown 7 passes tonight. Every one of them has been caught. The problem is 2 of them have been caught by these Cougars in the backfield.
That's too bad.
Second down for Washington State. Straight drop back for Gesser. He's going to go deep again. And that one's a little bit too far for Bush. And that brings up a third down for Washington State. And for the first time, the Wildcats have Washington State with a must complete a pass situation with 3:49 to go in the quarter.
That play is what you would expect out of Mike Price in this Washington State offense. They are always trying to attack the defense. Despite being ahead 28-7, they are continuing to try to execute plays that will give them an opportunity to put it into the end zone. And a lot of times on those deep passes, even if they are not successful in completing them, they always have the opportunity to get pass interference.
Yes, sir, with a big third down play. Straight drop, and that pocket has collapsed, and they're saying no, that his knee possibly hit the floor. And there's a flag on the field. I don't believe it was the clock. It must have been somebody moving. There are 5 seconds left on the play clock when the snap occurred. And it's against the Cougars, and the Wildcats will take it.
Jason Gesser, up to this point in the season, has thrown 12 touchdown passes and just one interception. That's an incredible ratio for a quarterback, 12-1.
False start, Jay Stryker says. And we believe it could have been Colin Henderson, number 83, the flanker. Tell you what, it's interesting for the Cougars, and in particular, Jason Gesser coming into this building. He had gone about 130 straight passes last year without throwing an interception. Until he came here, Michael
Jolivet. Fourth quarter.
Yep.
Fourth quarter. That was big play of the game.
He threw 6 touchdowns here last year in that incredible overtime game. All right, they're getting ready to restart the clock. 3:44 to go in the quarter. And a third down play ready for Washington State.
Washington State just embarrassed Cal's defense last week. We talked about the 51 points they scored against them, but just controlled the ball throughout that football game.
Minnick, the single setback. Out of the pocket. And Gesser is belted. He fumbles. And guess what? Touchdown, Arizona. Austin Uku scores for Arizona.
Dave... There is momentum. Jason Gesser back in the pocket, not looking to his weak side, his backside. Totally was taken off guard and had no opportunity to get control of that football. Once again, it was number 9 coming in that time for Arizona, Johnny Jackson, who has been on fire these last 2 weeks with his ability to sack the quarterback.
All right, Keel on. It tries to draw Arizona with 14, within 14. He does. And would you believe this script?
John Makovic clapping his hands. He knows momentum has shifted to his side of the field. Johnny Jackson, what a speed rusher that comes right off the corner despite being held. And makes great contact with the quarterback. And that's what you want to do as a defender. You want to separate the quarterback and the ball every time you get there.
These two teams playing tonight, the final weekend of September. But I'll tell you what, Doug, they are October Halloween weird. Just weird. Dana Cooper, how about this?
Arizona is successful in coming back in this game, and they still have a big hole to dig out of. It would break a 28-year-old record. Back in 1972, the Cats were down by 27 points at Utah and came back and won that game 28-27. So get another touchdown, and perhaps we're in the snip of a record here.
Thank you, Dana.
Dana, where did you get that information? This guy is a treasure chest of facts and figures.
He studies all week. All right, here's the kickoff. It's coming down into the end zone, and it's going to be returned. On the top this time, it's the same one. It's David again, and Jason David is finally knocked down at the 35-yard line, and that's where Jason Gesser and the Cougars get underway again. So both teams have scored on turnover plays tonight. The Cougars got on the scoreboard on Lamont Thompson's return of an interception that began the night, and Austin Uku just a moment ago was able to pick up the fumbled ball and score Arizona's third fumble recovery touchdown of the season.
Turnovers totally turn upside down normal statistics, but scoring points after getting turnovers on defense is a major part of football.
Yes, sir, on first down. Bootleg. hangs on to it. Now he's going to run in earnest, and he will pick up 5 yards out of bounds at the 40-yard line. That'll bring up second down and four for Washington State.
In the open, we talked about Jason Gesser being a very mobile and accurate quarterback. Last year, he rushed for 2 touchdowns, and this year, he has a 6-yard average every time he decides to go ahead and take off with the football. So it's another threat to the defense that they must be concerned with.
Well, I'll repeat the fact that number 17 in the middle of your screen threw for 348 yards here last year. Enough said. Second down and short yardage for Gesser and the Cougars. Minnick, the lone setback. 3 wide receivers outright. It's Minnick who gets the call, stumbles, fights, and he will be short. And again, it's a trio of Wildcats, Ray Wells amongst others, who were able to grab hold of Dave Minnick and wrestle him down to the floor. Also on that play, you see number 56, that's Keone Frazier out of Kalua High School in Honolulu. And Ray Wells, the freshman linebacker. As you take a look at Minnick's numbers tonight, 6 times he's carried the ball for 16 yards and a touchdown. And he also caught a pass for a touchdown as well. And we have got a... Well, the referees are pointing to one corner of the field. There's not been a timeout call. Let's find out what the point of irritation might be. It's an official's timeout. And according to Jay Strikers.
It's interesting because they almost let the play run, then at the last second, stormed in front of the ball.
Well, there are members of Arizona's bench, and some of the players are looking at that east sideline as if they're looking into the seats or they're beyond the field.
Mike Price, as you said, with the most Pac-10 wins, I believe it's, 112 wins
mm-hmm.
that he currently has under his belt, but a real gentleman and a coach.
112 wins with 117 losses at 2 schools, and flags fly everywhere as the Cougars have the ball down in their backfield at the 40-yard line.
One thing the Wildcats are excellent at is recovering fumbles this year. There's been 7 times the opposition has put the ball on the ground, and they've come away with 6 of those.
You're going to see a bunch of Cougars jumping. It's a procedure call against Washington State, so they go backwards. Yep. 5-yard penalty. A couple have jumped early for Mike Price. And I tell you what, there's a little bit different concern as we have word now for the Wildcats. Lance Briggs has a cut. Here's Gesser way up for Bush. It's a jump ball, but it's out of bounds, and there is no flag. And Arizona's defense has held again.
I'm surprised that Gesser did not throw that ball inside so that Bush had an opportunity to use his height and leaping ability. You'll see Gesser just throws the ball up at the last second before under heavy duress.
Jose Ofele and Young Thompson combined to explain how nice the turf here at Arizona Stadium truly is. Punting for the Cougars is Alan Cox. Cox gets it away. And it's a beautiful kick. Bobby Wade fields it at the 20-yard line. And can he find a wall of blockers? Can he beat a man? He's taken down at the 28-yard line, where Arizona has its best starting field position of the night. Now, I'll tell you what, Doug, we've seen enough miscues, mistakes, problems, and things right out of the get-go.
And you could want to execute, but when you turn the ball over like the Wildcats did early in the game, it's very difficult to try to combat that.
On first down, play action fake, stays in the pocket, wobbles it across the middle, and that one's picked off. That was one just a few moments ago. That was another interception. All right. Little Farmer trying to make something on his own. The Farmer out into the Washington State backfield. He got a chance to roam. He's got a first down. And the problems were not limited to just plays from scrimmage. I mean, the Wildcats had their special teams hurt them a little bit, like this unexpected onside kick.
Well, they discussed three phases of the football game, and the Wildcats have had breakdowns on all three phases early in the first quarter, but they swung this momentum on their side, though. Defensively, they took control of the game.
All right, Johnson with the eye backfield. Detweiler in front, blocks for Farmer. He goes straight ahead for the first down. They had marked Farmer out of bounds about 6 inches shy of a first down, so that was just straight ahead running off the left guard. And I tell you what, you start thinking about how you engineer a comeback, and it's going to come in not only to the ball carrying of Farmer, but the blocking of those guys across the front. Freitas, Sampe, Grace, Barry, and Saffernick. And Doug, these guys have started now every game this year, and they're healthy.
The offensive line should be a big help as this game unfolds, but John Makovic looking for a play that's going to work against this defense.
And on the blitz, he swings it out and swings it to the other side of the field, and it's intercepted by Jason David. Incredible. The third interception of the night for Washington State.
Washington State coming with a blitz that time. They're right behind Arizona in terms of sacks in the Pac-10. But Jason Johnson threw the ball to the inside instead of the outside. You'll see the pressure that he's under, and he just tried to get rid of the football, but he threw it to the inside.
Boy, this is an absolutely strange game.
Well, most fans see what happens on the other end of the football with the interception, but they don't see what happens on the throwing end. And 90% of interceptions are caused by pressure against the quarterback and his hurrying by throwing the ball.
Yes, sir. On first down after the turnover, nearly has it picked. Oh, boy, who was it? I think that was Keone Frazier, number 56, who almost picked it off. Keone out of Honolulu, and he had to get that 282 frame up.
Well, that was good anticipation on his behalf. Last year, he recovered 5 fumbles, so he's accustomed to being around the football. He anticipated that screen pass. There's a way that you can notice it by the way the offensive line is blocking, and he read it early and went out there and nearly made an interception.
Well, Frazier's from Hawaii, and so is Gesser, who played at St. Louis and Honolulu. Not exactly aloha. Here is a give to the left side. That is Minnick, and he is close to the first down. Oh, I take that back. It wasn't Minnick. It was Allen Thompson, who gets a couple of calls per game, too. Thompson spelling Minnick on that play. He averages about 34 yards a game, so not bad running behind Minnick. So the freshman, Allen Thompson, as we mentioned, back of him, and he's close to the first down. Third down and 2. The give. And that's to Thompson as well. And he's close to the first down. He's got the first down.
What makes it difficult when you're on defense and you're playing against this Washington State offense is the fact that you don't know where the ball is going to go. On every one of their plays, they are either faking a handoff, bringing a receiver across the middle. There's so much different motion with this offense that you're reluctant many times to go ahead and attack what you think is the initial handoff, because we've seen Jason Gesser roll out, run with a football, or he actually bootleg and throws it down the field.
And on first down, Gesser with a lot of time, headed for Mike Bush again, who has become one of his favorite receivers tonight anyway. And that ball is overthrown, incomplete.
Mike Bush is tall, and he might have had a chance to catch that, but he would have been in the 7-foot range to get a hand on that one. That ball was just thrown too high. Gesser was throwing the ball downfield, thinking that he would give Bush an opportunity to run under, but that was good coverage by Joel Levette. He was on him like flypaper.
And as soon as that ball passes over the head, he's fair game. Here's Mike Bush with 4 catches tonight, 72 yards and a touchdown. Second down for the Cougars at the 33-yard line of Arizona. Gesser with time throws it, and that one is incomplete. Nice defensive play. Pass broken up that time by Brandon Nash. And now it's a third down play for Washington State.
Brandon Nash is good at anticipating the throw here. This is a timing route. When Gesser decides to throw it to the inside, Nash knew where the receiver was going to go and broke to the inside, and that was a nice pass deflection. There was good anticipation on his part in knowing what the route was going to be.
Doug, you were talking about momentum. This is a bit unusual. Justin Gesser, 1 of 7 in his last 7 attempts passing, third down and 10. Gesser is going to air it out deep to Michael Jolovet. Unbelievable, it continues. That was Nakoa McElreth, who was the intended receiver, and the ball wasn't even close.
Jason Gesser must have a mental block with Michael Jolovet. He loves throwing this guy footballs. That time, it wasn't as though Jolovet even broke on the ball. He was playing his own defense, and the ball was thrown right at him, almost like a punt returner. I don't understand why Gesser could not have seen him. He was leading the receiver to the outside, but he had to have seen Jolovet waiting for the football.
One more play remains in the first quarter. And both coaches may breathe a sigh of relief. Thompson throws it to the intended receiver that time as Melosi Leonard, and that ball is incomplete, and that brings up a second down play, and I believe the first quarter has expired. And it has. Well, Arizona Stadium tonight is the theater of the bizarre, and we've got three quarters to go after the first 15. Washington State 28, Arizona 14. Hurry back now. They say it's not good for you to go to bed angry. It's better to go to bed mad. Mad TV, weeknights at 10:35 on Arizona's WB58 Cable 8. Well, welcome to It's a Mad, 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 Mad World at Arizona Stadium tonight. One quarter is done, and it's already 28-14. Washington State led by 28-0, and the Wildcats now trying to get within seven. And Jason Johnson, who is now 5 of 8 tonight, and his three incomplete passes have all been intercepted. On first down, he airs it out, and that's a little bit too tall for Brandon Marshall, and that's how we begin play in the second quarter.
Those are some incredible statistics for one quarter of play. I don't care if it is in the Pac-10 or not, but Washington State piled up some yards on the passing yards, but fortunately for them, most times the balls were turned over deep in Arizona's territory, so they didn't have to go very far on their drives.
It's a remarkable rivalry. We're delighted to have it with you. On second down, very quickly puts it out, and that is bobbled and finally out of the hands of Andre Thurman. And Arizona has to send the punt unit on. Ramey Peru has already hit the ball once tonight.
Jason Johnson is not the same consistent, accurate passer that we've seen earlier this season. He's been throwing the ball to the inside, outside, overthrowing receivers. This has been unlike the performance that we saw from him earlier this season.
So Peru, the sophomore, has been punting very well this season. His longest punt is 51 yards, and that's what the Wildcats are hoping he can do right now. Just gets that one away. Good rush. And it's taken at midfield. And it was Colin Henderson who was spun around immediately after taking the ball. And Washington State has pretty good field position nonetheless. Gary Love came down on special teams and made the play. You want to be a punt returner?
Well, the coverage team does a very good job here in terms of maintaining their lanes of discipline, but that is not a fun job. It is so difficult to try to catch a ball that's been moving. A lot of times those balls, they when they're hit, they're not at spirals, but they have a tendency to float. Very difficult to make catches, knowing there's 11 guys wanting to hit you as soon as you do.
Matt Kegel is the new quarterback for Washington State. So this book of weird football just opens another chapter right now. Kegel, a sophomore, he has established himself as the steady number two quarterback for Washington State. Completes about 71% of his passes. He's thrown 10 completions in 14 attempts so far. As Jason Gesser now out of the ballgame after having some problems of his own.
Kegel, he likes the big plays too. His first pass as a Cougar was an 88-yard touchdown, and he started the last two games of last season.
Well, we've understood that Washington State oftentimes will make this switch, and Kegel, not understanding exactly how Arizona reacted to the man in motion, calls a timeout. Jeremy Thielbar got everyone's attention, and as a result, we stopped the clock. We've got 14 minutes to go in the first half. Washington State out in front by 14. Back at Arizona Stadium, I'm Dave Sittin along with Doug Plank and Dana Cooper. We open our Casino of the Sun trivia tonight with this question. What school did the Wildcats defeat in their very first Pac-10 home opener? It was way back when. And I know what many of you are going to do. Turn on that box in your house and look on the internet. You real fans will remember. We'll get to the answer in just a little bit. The Wildcats are trying to answer Washington State right now. Matt Kegel fires down. That one might be picked. Instead, it's batted away by a pair of Wildcats. On the coverage that time was Jermaine Chapman. And he was joined over there. And I want to believe that that was Brandon Nash who helped him out.
It's always good to have two defenders on the play because you make sure that the receiver definitely has no choice. But that time, especially when you're guarding against a guy like Mike Bush at 6'6", he has the ability to reach up and try to take the ball away from defenders. But that time, credit the Arizona defense. Brandon Nash that time came over and made certain that ball was going to fall incomplete.
Well, I've seen Lute Olson's teams double-team Mike Bush. Now John Makovic's team get in the act as well. Quick in and out of the hands, and that was intended for McElreth. That's Nakoa. Came in leading the nation with 163. How about this dropped ball?
Well, he's got real good ears on this one. He was anticipating getting hit. He really did not want to try to catch that ball. The incredible thing about this kid is he was averaging 22 yards per reception, but noticed a feeble effort in trying to gain possession of that ball.
Fourth down for the Cougars. Alan Cox in to punt for Washington State. A lot of strange goings. Now, boy, he hung this one near the moon. A fair catch called by Bobby Wade, and he sets the ball down at the 7 and make that the 12.5-yard line. Cox with a nice job. That is the fourth time this year, that he's placed an opponent team inside the 20. A full moon tonight, wouldn't you guess?
Yeah, they could probably blame it on that early on, but in the offseason, Mike Price wanted to improve his special teams, and he did it in a dramatic way. You could see that both his kickoff, his kickers, as well as his punters have improved dramatically from last season.
On first down, Johnson gives the Farmer dance and is drugged down immediately, and I believe that was Tupo to Upo who made the stop. On Farmer, and that brings up a second down after a pickup of a couple.
Well, you have to establish, that running game. Even though your primary emphasis is try to pass the football, you still need to go ahead and be able to consistently run the football to control the clock and pick up those tough yards.
Single setback behind, and the give is to Farmer again, off left tackle. Nothing terribly fancy about that. He picks up another 2 yards. Should be about third down and 5 for Arizona. And I'll tell you what, after the first 11 minutes of this game, and in case you've just joined us, Arizona spotted Washington State 28 points to begin the game. 28-0. Arizona has come back to score 14. And now the Wildcats with their work cut out for them as Farmer out of the ballgame. Tremaine Cox in for the Wildcats. Third down. Thompson with plenty of time, and he hooks it up. Completed pass. Andre Thurman with a catch, and he took a beating. There's a flag down at the area of the tackle. Billy Newman, the strong safety with a stop. And that would likely be a foul against Washington State.
I think they may get Billy Newman for putting his helmet down. He was a leading tackler on this Cougar defense the last couple years. Tries to make himself as a real tough guy in the secondary, but he certainly delivered a blow that time when he came over and made contact. But I believe he may be, well, those are the ones that are hard to hold on to.
Contact, personal foul on the defense. 15-yard penalty from the end of the catch. First down.
That is a huge penalty. You take the 15 yards from the spot of the foul at the end of the play, and Arizona picks up a tidy bit of real estate on the one play. And I know, Mr. Plank, having done this sort of thing before, you'll enjoy this.
They used to love that back in the 80s. Well, suddenly things have changed, but look at the job Thurman does by holding onto the football. That would have been very easy for him to let that go incomplete.
Andre with two catches tonight. Now Leo Mills into the act. He sweeps around right side, picks up about 5 yards. It'll be second down and five for Arizona with 12 minutes remaining in the first half.
If there's been anything that Arizona's done right tonight, it's been in the penalty department. They have no penalties thus far. They've been averaging 9 penalties coming into this game. Washington State has 3 penalties for 25 yards. But Leo Mills, he's been a great addition in that backfield in giving Clarence Farmer a breather.
Leo came in averaging just under 3 yards per carry. Arizona now tightens up the line on second down. Johnson straight back, pitches it outside, and it is complete to Bobby Wade, who has enough for the first down. And it was Reniel Smith who was hanging on for dear life along with Jason David.
You had to know that it was only going to be a matter of time before they started going to Bobby Wade. He had 14 receptions coming into tonight's game, but he does a great job of making very sharp cuts and getting to the outside.
Big series for the Wildcats, which began at the 12 and a half yard line. Now they're close to the red zone. The give is to Farmer, and the Cougars are blitzing. They picked him up in the backfield. He gets back to the line of scrimmage. It becomes second down. Smith, Price, and others. Reniel Smith, 6'2" senior. And he was back in the Arizona backfield in a hurry. He was born in Mesa, Arizona. Spent most of his time up in the Washington area.
This is not the same Cougar defense that you've seen in the past. Up until tonight, they had not allowed any rushing touchdowns, and they've been holding opponents to just 16 points a game.
Tremaine Cox gets the draw play, and the Cougars waited for that as well. That brings up a third down and about 10 for Arizona. Arizona has been trying to start that rushing offense tonight, but Doug, you see that this is indeed one of the better rushing defenses in college football.
It's surprising to see the dramatic turnaround in this defense. Last year, Washington State was at the bottom of the Pac-10 in scoring defense and total defense. What a dramatic turnaround in just 1 year.
High formation. Now they shift out Detweiler as an H-back. On third and 10, Johnson with a pump fake. He's going to go to the end zone, and he's got a step. Bobby Wade, touchdown! Bobby Wade places the 48th point on the scoreboard. First half.
That's exactly the same play that we saw last week. Bobby Wade faking that he was going to do a quick out, instead takes it up the field, and he victimizes Eric Coleman, number 27.
Just a sophomore who had an interception coming into the game, and Wade and Johnson hook up, and Keel can make this a 7-point contest, and he does. Just when you thought you saw it all, this happens. Arizona scoring very close to your coffee table in your living room. And would you believe they're within 7? We'll be right back.
Welcome back to Arizona Stadium. We got 49 points on the board, and there's still 10 minutes left in the first half. When these two teams took the field tonight, they were kind of like young, handsome studs showing up for the dance, whooping and strutting their stuff. The problem is they both kind of came in wearing polyester leisure suits. The combined record of their opponents was 2-16, so nobody could convincingly say that either team was really very good. Well, I think we've learned a little something about each team so far here in the first half.
Ryan Slack's kick is taken by Jason David, and the Arizona special teams knock him down at the 13-yard line. How about the Wildcats, and that play was made by Shelton Ross, a linebacker on special teams.
Football is all about momentum, and it's not just on the offense and defense. It carries over to special teams. In fact, special teams, I think, really ignite football teams in terms of the emotion and the attitude. And you can feel this emotion swinging towards the Arizona sideline after those early turnovers.
Jason Gesser returns after a series away. Matt Kegel went 0 for 2 passing. Gesser 6 for 14. He's had problems with his last 7 in a row. And on first down, play action fake from the 5-yard line. Throws it up for grabs, and it's knocked away. It was Jermaine Chapman who knocked it down. The intended receiver was Nakoa McElrath. And I'll tell you what, interesting tonight, Doug, is the stars who are not having their big nights tonight. McElrath, who is one of the leading receivers in the nation, statistically number one in one of those, and now he's been quieted considerably.
I'm surprised how Washington State has dropped off dramatically in their offensive execution.
Second down and 10 for Washington State. Give is to Minnick. Minnick is dragged down in the backfield, and coming up was Brandon Nash, who made the play at the line of scrimmage from his safety position.
Brandon Nash is one of those strong, physical type of defenders. You can feel this defense starting to play with some purpose, some vengeance, and they're not wanting just to get the ball carrier on the ground. They want to do it with an attitude.
So Brandon Nash, the senior, who recovered a fumble and scored a pivotal touchdown against San Diego State in the opener, makes a big tackle that brings up third down and 9. Gesser, pump fake, gonna air it out. And that's way over Mike Bush, but there are flags everywhere. And I believe they're gonna say that the Wildcats held Bush as he made his way up the field. Brandon Nash pleads. It's a hold against Arizona, and let's have another look.
When you're 6'6", though, there's a lot of things to grab a hold of, and you see Mike Bush starts trying to take it up the field. You'll see
holding prior to the pass being thrown on the defense. 10-yard penalty, previous spot, automatic first down.
Now Jermaine Chapman.
The left-handed Jermaine Chapman reached back and grabbed Bush as he was running down the field.
Well, they mark off 10, automatic first down, and Washington State now dodges a bullet. On that third down play now, they have a first down at the 24-yard line. But nonetheless, the Wildcats have made it a game. It was 28-0 in favor of the Cougars to begin. Now it's 28-21, and we still have nearly 9 minutes remaining in the second quarter. And now more flags are evident, and I believe it's a procedural call against Washington State.
When you watch these football teams on offense, defense, and even special teams for that matter, they are so similar. It's almost looking into the mirror. It's no wonder that these teams have battled close games over the last couple years, high-scoring affairs. They have the same offense, and they have the same type of aggressive defense. And other than the rushing statistics for Arizona, which is a big discrepancy from Washington State, everything else pretty much seems to be in order.
First down and 15. Give it to Minnick straight up the middle. He stays on his feet, and the Marine powers his way to the 26-yard line. And it took several Wildcats to finally get him onto the ground, Joe Ciofili being one of them. Let's have a look, and as you see him launched at Arizona.
And Minnick did a nice job there and recognized that there was a running back, a cutback opportunity, and he made a couple defenders miss him in picking up a couple extra yards. But as I said, this guy is not just a slouch player. He's strong, he loves to lift weights, and he's fast.
And he's pretty intelligent, too. Gesser went the wrong way, and the Wildcats were all over him, including that one, Brandon Nash with the sack.
This may not be the Desert Swarm, but they're doing a pretty good imitation tonight. They are coming from all angles. Brandon Nash coming off the corner. He had to love it when he saw Jason Gesser roll to the weak side, thinking he was going to buy himself some additional time. Just didn't happen.
And Junior Ray Wells, number 7, a very happy participant just to be that close. How about this now? Third down, 19, the ball spotted at the 15. The draw play is Dominick, and he's got a lot of room across the 30, still on his feet. Knocked down after getting the first down, and it took Michael Jolovet to come back and get him.
David Minnick has become a very important part of their offense. He not only runs the football, but he also is a good receiver coming out of the backfield. You'll see the Gesser wastes no time in getting him the football deep in the backfield, and he does the rest. He finds the running lane to the outside. He gets an initial block at the line of scrimmage, and the rest is Dave Minnick down the field.
And I believe it was number 52, Tyler Hunt, the center, who did a very good job of hanging on to Lance Briggs when Minnick made the break. First down and 10 for Washington State. 7 minutes to go in the quarter. The Wildcats stop them at the line of scrimmage.
David Minnick was in the top 10 in the Pac-10 rushers coming into tonight's game, averaging 5 yards a carry. And he hasn't surprised anybody. Through tonight, he's had 10 carries for 51 yards. So he's right on his average.
It was Allen Thompson on the carry as we took another look at Tyler Hunt, the junior, who made a very good block slash hold, if you will, on Lance Briggs. It didn't get caught, so it didn't happen. Second down and 10 for Washington State at their own 42-yard line. Gesser with one back behind him. He stays in the block. Across the middle he goes. It's hauled in by Bush, and he's very close to the first down. Boy, Mike Bush is making some great catches tonight. By the way, that catch just in time for Gesser. This is his first completion in his last 8 attempts.
See Bush taking it to the inside. He knows he's going to get hit, but he still holds on to the football. And for a guy that's 6'6", that's coming right into your living room. That's a great camera shot. But you can see Mike Bush is going to be a little sore tomorrow when he gets out of that bed.
Coming up on the 6-minute mark in just the first half. 28-21, Washington State. Big series now. First down. Give it, sweep around the right side to Minnick, and he puts the ball down on the 45-yard line. A pickup of 3. He was sandwiched that time by Brandon Nash and to Lance Briggs, and that brings up a second down and 7.
In normal running situations, this defense is designed to stop all the interior running holes and force the running backs to the outside. That's what happened that time. But the Arizona defense was able to quickly get to the outside on the perimeter and make the tackle. But this defense is designed to stop up those interior running lanes.
Lance Briggs has been busy. Came in leading Arizona in tackles to start the night. And who moved first? Yep, they say it's a legal play. No flags going down. Gesser is going to be knocked out of bounds by Worcester. Boy, that's a strange play.
Very strange. When you're on defense, you are not supposed to stop, though, until you hear at least one whistle, sometimes two. Just keep going, because it's a live ball.
Well, perhaps we can catch what happened there. The ball is not snapped. Arizona, oh, there it was. It was snapped by Hunt. And then the bedlam ensued.
You think that was a design play, Dave?
I would wonder how you practice that.
No.
How do you practice that particular play? All right, it's a third down now. Third and 7 at the 45-yard line. 5:08 remain in the first half. A 7-point game. And Gesser with a single setback Minnick. Tosses across the middle, wide open to Thielbar. And Thielbar is into Arizona territory for the first down. He's knocked it down at the 27-yard line. Michael Jolovet makes the stop. Thielbar, the big tight end, a senior at 6'2", and just drags across the middle wide open.
And they use Thielbar in a lot of different situations. Sometimes as a running back, sometimes as a tight end. He's one of those H-back type players that they a lot of times split out 1 yard deep and 1 yard outside the tackle position. But he's a good receiver coming out of the backfield. He's been bothered by some injuries last couple years, but he seems pretty healthy tonight.
And the seniors, Aharius Johnson, helped along that tackle as well on first down. Gesser looking towards the middle, fires again, and it's Bush again, and he is knocked down at the 20-yard line. A good pickup for Washington State. It'll be a second down and short. Dana Cooper joins us once again.
Dave, here's Mike Bush's bio in the Washington State media guide. There are six paragraphs in here and exactly 18 words about his involvement in football.
Uh-huh.
Four paragraphs all about basketball. They couldn't find anything until this year to say about Mike Bush for football, but he's speaking very loudly in this game right now.
Well, Dana, as you know, we'll see him here in Tucson in January, and I'm sure the basketball book's going to have some football literature in it. As that play off tackle doesn't work, a little counter trap, and the Wildcats were wise to it. Brings up a third down and short yardage. Young Thompson amongst the blue-shirted Wildcats to make the stop.
Dana was talking about Mike Bush. He has almost 100 yards already. Those six catches, he only had 11 catches coming into tonight's game. It's almost a certainty that he'll go over 100 yards. And last week against Cal, Washington State had three receivers that had at least 100 yards receiving, which was a school record.
He is the pride of Meridian High School in Riverside, California, is Mike Bush. The give is to Minnick on the third down and short. And that's going to be a Marine Bulldogs try to get over there. And he just does establish the beachhead near the 16-yard line. First down for Washington State. And it took the play by Johnny Jackson to get him down even at that.
This is an important drive for Arizona. They cannot allow Washington State to get into the end zone. At the very minimum, they have to keep them to a field goal because they are using the clock, eating up time of possession, and not giving Arizona much of an opportunity for the remainder of this quarter.
Cougars with a first down at the 16, and Gesser's going right across the middle to Bush. It's in and out of his hands. And it was Michael Jolivet who was with him who knocked it away.
Michael Jolivet has great timing as a defensive back, and he comes in at the last second and is able to get his hand between Bush's when he's trying to make possession of that football. But Michael Jolivet anticipates where that ball is going to be and strips it away at the last second. See Bush running free, and he thinks he's going to have an easy catch. Jolivet uses his acceleration to make the play at the end.
And Washington State uses another timeout with 2 minutes and 48 seconds to go. The Cougars have one more remaining, but we're going to send you home for just a couple of seconds. Hurry back. Well, everybody looking for answers here. And if you were looking for the Casino the Sun trivia answer, we'll roll it out right now. What school did the Wildcats defeat in their first Pac-10 home opener? It was those Beavers back on 9-16, September 16th.
Well, they used to be a doormat back in the 70s, right, Dave?
Yeah.
After that game today.
And you and I saw that today. They kind of returned to their former selves. Yes, sir. On second down and 10. Way back with the drop. Lays it out for Minnick, and Minnick is close to a first down inside the 10-yard line. It was Brandon Nash who brought him down. Well, you talk about that Pac-10 opener back in 79, the student body here. It was still in mom's wombs, most of them. As you take a look at Minnick again, and you were right, Doug, you were talking about this man's versatility. We've seen him catch the ball, block, we've seen him carry the ball, he does it all.
And the defenses against the Washington State are set up to stop the receivers, not the running backs.
Third and short yardage, and just shove it ahead. All about seven guys moving forward all together, and that will make it first and goal for Washington State. And it was Jason Gesser who was... Tell you what, you want to go on a quick trip with Jason? That's a very short commute, but very effective. Off the blocks of the left guard Phil Locker and the center Tyler Hunt. And first and goal now with a minute and 54 seconds remaining first half. Gesser and the Cougars trying to move back out in front by 14. This a toss, sweep it to Minnick, and he makes it a 13-point lead for Washington State. Boy, that's just a big old lineup, knock people over and run it into the end zone play, Doug.
Dave Minnick averaging as I said, 5 yards a carry. He's piled up about 65 yards thus far in tonight's game with 38 receiving yards. But Dave Minnick is patient. He waits to get to the outside and then waits for a running lane on the interior. Then he runs with some authority into the end zone.
And there you saw Jermaine Chapman thinking that he was trying to tackle a motor vehicle. And the conversion is straight down the middle, and the Cougars, in this incredible half of football, which, by the way, is not complete quite yet, have scored 35 in Arizona 21. And let's take one more look at Minnick's gallop.
And Dave Minnick, he piled up over 700 yards last year, coming in playing sparingly during the season. But you can just tell the way he's running very confidently this year that they don't have any problem at all giving him the football inside the 10-yard line.
And why not get yourself a big old fan and relax here in southern Arizona? This Dave Minnick, 14 rushes for 63 yards, a couple of touchdowns that way, receiving a couple of catches for 38 yards and a touchdown. 3 touchdowns tonight. My goodness.
And he's really a thorn in the side of defenses because they are so geared to stopping that potent passing attack on the outside that you just don't anticipate running backs and tight ends, which Washington State uses very effectively in this passing offense. And especially when you have a running back like Dave Minnick that can either run the football or come out of the backfield. And he showed how capable he is of making catches on that drive.
Yep. They call him a tough runner, tough football player. They also call him Daddy. He and his wife, Kirsten, have a couple of kids. And his team's out in front by 14. Here's a line drive that does just make it over the cone. That's a legal kick through the end zone. And Arizona will have the football at the 20-yard line. Another good play by the Cougars kicker, Adam Holliday, number 4. The longest scoring drive of the night for either team is an 8-minute, 6-second journey by Washington State. 18 plays, 87 yards, and it was capped by Dave Minnick's 6-yard rush to the end zone.
Dave, that looks more like a Big Ten stat, not a Pac-10.
Yeah.
8 minutes scoring drives. One of the goals Mike Price had this year for his offensive team, though, was to consistently be able to drive the ball over 50 yards for scores.
Jason Johnson trying to get the Wildcats within 7, fires it out to Bobby Wade, and Wade was a little bit further downfield, tried to come back to make the catch, incomplete, it becomes 2nd down. And going back to what we talked about at the start of the show, and I find this most remarkable, we said there was a chance we'd get into triple digits for a football score here tonight. With 1:37 remaining in the first half, we have scored 56 so far.
This is actually Washington State's ahead of their normal scoring. They're averaging 43 points a game, but they already have 35 here in the first half.
Johnson with help in the backfield, flags on the play, and I believe it's going to be offside against the left side of the Washington State line. It may have been Ty Tupai who jumped off, but we'll see.
Made by 97 Ty Tupai and 10 Billy Newman.
That is the guy, Ty Tupai. Big number 97, 6'5", 332 pounds. That is a glimpse of real estate, ladies and gentlemen. Monterey High School in California.
Washington State bringing a run blitz that time, which meant that they filled all the running lanes. So despite running a draw, which you would think you would catch the defense off guard, instead, Washington State had every one of the running lanes on the interior filled with defenders.
Big tie on the quick pitch to Farmer, trying to get around the edge, and he is belted out of bounds at the 25-yard line. And that'll bring up a 3rd down for the Wildcats. It was Ryanall Smith along with Isaac Brown who escorted Farmer off the field of play. 3rd down and 5 for Arizona, and all of a sudden this becomes a key play with 1:26 remaining in the first half.
Arizona cannot afford to give this football up. They must score on this drive. It's very important at the end of the first half to score, be able to carry some of that momentum with you into the second half.
Well, the Wildcat offense in the wrong red zone right now. On 3rd down and 5, Thompson's toss is caught, but it is short. Bobby Wade, the receiver, or make that Andre Thurman, And Thurman is hit out of bounds, a yard shy. And Doug, I'm sure there's a little bit of temptation, but the way things have got tonight, why fool with fate? The punt team comes onto the field.
Thurman has to understand where the first down is. Although that was a successful completion, he could have very easily been able to take that ball 3 or 4 yards further up the field so that when he made the catch, it would have been a first down.
Ramey Peru is hitting the ball about 5 yards beyond his average of the season with a 41-yard average tonight, getting ready to kick the ball away to Washington State. And it should be Colin Henderson back waiting for it, and we've got the timeout. So with 37 seconds to go, a timeout on the field. The Cougars are hoping to get at least a sniff at perhaps a field goal attempt. But John Makovic, you know, I'll tell you what about John tonight, watching him as the Wildcats had their spell in the first quarter, and I presume that's a good way to explain it. Looked pretty much like a guy he worked for a couple of decades ago down in Dallas. Coach Landry didn't show much emotion through all of it, and tonight he's kept a pretty level head as well.
I think players want to see some composure in their head coach. I've had coaches, Woody Hayes, Mike Ditka, tearing up clipboards, running down the sidelines.
Coach Hayes? Coach Hayes do that?
Breaking the first down markers. You know, it's great entertainment, but it doesn't do anything for your composure. Mike Price, another fully composed coach, the dean of the Pac-10 coaching staff right now. He's somebody who truly enjoys his players. I think he enjoys the personal one-on-one relationships that he has with many of those players. And he's been around a long time, so he's doing something successful.
Yeah, he's down there on the sideline right now looking like he's the Ryder Cup captain, you know. Gentlemen, let's go for the green here on this. Oh, he's seen a lot, and he's taken his team to the Rose Bowl, and forever will be kindly regarded in the Palouse. A snap a little bit high, but Peru is able to belt it, and it's coming down to Henderson, and Henderson draws a flag, and I believe the Wildcats were within the ring. Might have been Gary Love in there. They have to give the punt returner enough space. It's a 5-yard penalty.
It's the halo, isn't it, Dave? The,
yep.
The halo. Actually, that's a suicide play in college when you're a punt returner.
Interference with the opportunity to make a catch on the kicking team. 5-yard penalty for the spot of the ball.
Yeah, it's a 5-yarder, and it's, I'll tell you what, that's a little ticky-tacky one because you saw David Hinton, the cornerback, was on special teams that time.
Well, why?
Yeah.
What happens many times, you will have coaches that coach special teams that if you have a very valuable and dangerous returner, they'll just send guys down there to destroy the returner and take the 5-yard penalty. It's almost of little significance.
All right, Gesser on first down goes to Minnick. Minnick squirts ahead, stays on his feet, headed to the sideline, out of bounds at the 42-yard line. And the Cougars have the clock stopped with a first down with 20 seconds remaining in the half. And the ball spotted at the Arizona 40. They're going to mark it at the 43-yard line. It was Jarvie Worcester who chased him out of bounds.
David Minnick using the stiff arm very effectively once he broke to the outside. But this Washington State team seems motivated to try to get on the scoreboard with every opportunity.
Well, they spread the field wide, two wide to the far side, two to the near side. Yes, sir. Still with the ball on the bootleg, fires it, and it is a completed pass. And finally out of bounds is Jerome Riley. And Riley with his first catch of the night, the junior, number 84. Jason Gesser has got these kids on the move again.
And that is so difficult, being a right-handed quarterback, to be able to spin like he did, run to his left-hand side, and be able to throw that ball as accurately with as much velocity. That is a very difficult aspect for many quarterbacks to master.
All right, it's a first down. The ball now is at the 25-yard line. That play took 9 seconds, so 11 remain in the half. Cats need to make a big play. Here's Gesser. And he may just run out of bounds, and he does at the 35-yard line. It will be a tall order for Drew Dunning to kick a ball that far. He's not made a field goal beyond 39 yards this season, but they're going to send him out there. Now watch this. Colin Henderson is the young man we've been watching running back punts. He is also the holder, and as a holder, as a passer for Washington State, he is 6-for-6 in his career. That's number 83 right there. And as a matter of fact, Nicoah McElrath jokes that he is the best passer on the team.
You're right. I think two of those have gone for touchdowns.
So watch out for the fake and the throw. It's going to be an attempted field goal by Dunning, and it is off to the left. And Washington State concludes this bizarre half of football with a missed field goal, and the two teams head to the locker room to catch their breaths. Well, in the first 30 minutes of this game, we saw just about everything. And we've got plenty more coming in the second half, including our halftime activity. So stick around. We've got a lot coming your way with our score, 35-21.
No, that's not a final score. It's only half, folks. 35-21. The Cougars lead Arizona. Dana Cooper standing by to tell us about all these points.
Dave, it's kind of amazing. Washington State opened the game with 28 unanswered points. Arizona came back with 21 unanswered points. 49 of the points that are on the board now were scored consecutively by the two teams. Now that Washington State has a 14-point lead at halftime, you'll recall that one of the things we talked about at the top of the telecast was their proclivity to control the ball 9 minutes more per game than their opponent. Don't be surprised now if they start to do that and go into that ball control offense that you saw so effectively and that 8-minute drive that ended the first half. Back upstairs.
Thank you so much, Dana. Well, after what we've seen, I don't think anybody will be surprised to see anything tonight, Doug.
No, we were anticipating a high-scoring game, and this is certainly going to meet that effort.
Oh, and this is just the opening week of the Pac-10. And speaking of Pacific 10 Conference plays, that time of year, there's been a lot of games around the conference. And let's take a look right now. The UCLA Bruins go up and stun Oregon State, a sad Razor Stadium crowd today, 38-7. Washington rallies. They were being beaten all over the place by California, but the Huskies come up with a 31-28 win. Elsewhere, a final score, Stanford 21-16 over the Trojans. Oregon struggling with Utah State in the fourth quarter, 24-21, and San Jose State staying in the ballgame with Arizona State up in Tempe. And that would take a look at the standings real quick in the Pacific 10 Conference for the first weekend. Going into the conference play, we saw these two teams at least, Arizona, Washington State, with perfect records. UCLA now 4-0. Arizona, for the moment, 3-0. Oregon, 3-0. And right on down the line, it's been a pretty good preseason for the teams in the Pacific 10 Conference. All right, when we come back, we've got plenty of football coming your way and a lot more coming at halftime. So stick around. We'll be right back to Arizona Stadium right after these words. Hi, I'm Tom. A wild and woolly football contest, the Pac-10 opener for the Arizona Wildcats at home. Well, it's been just over 2 weeks since everything in America changed, and as you see now, we still have the American flag flying in front of our broadcast position. We watch these youngsters play every Saturday across the country. It's interesting to find out what they learned, what they now know, as a result of the incident on September 11th. So our own Sean Mooney had a chance to catch up with them and talk to them. Let's find out what's on the minds of the Wildcats.
I'm very prideful and proud of our country. We're so resilient. It's good to be so strong and like know that when things happen, we can all come back and just pull together and be strong as a nation.
It feels great to be in America. It's hard to, you know, to understand, you know, what happened, you know, last week. But I feel that, you know, it's what happened last week. I think it's bringing our country together.
You know, by choice, I'm going to school. It's just because I have the freedom to do that. You know, I have the freedom to play football. You know, when they interrupted that and got games canceled, it's kind of, they took away our freedom to play football. And that's just something, you know, that I took for granted. And of course, something like this, you know, put it all in perspective. So.
To be be American is a dream, and it means freedom, and it's something that people will give anything to have what we have. You know, people in Africa or in different other countries do not have the luxury that we have. Being American is a dream come true.
In America, we have the freedom to go out there and do what we please. That's one of the best things about it.
Some most important thoughts about country duty at all from young men we watch play each and every week. All right, we'll get back in the football business when we return. We've got highlights for you right after these messages. It's halftime at Arizona Stadium. The visiting Washington State Cougars in their second Pac-10 game enjoy a 14-point advantage over the Wildcats, 35-21. And Doug Plank, just another garden variety, 8-touchdown first half between these two schools.
We anticipated a lot of scoring, but not as much early as what took place in this game.
Well, let's take a quick look, because it all began when the ball was picked off.
Lamont Thompson, big turnover here early in the game. Johnson never saw him as he quickly broke on that ball. Perfect timing. And then David Minnick had an outstanding first half, finding the open lanes, but he also showed the ability to come out of the backfield, catching the screen pass, and taking it in for a touchdown. But David Minnick, very tough, aggressive running back. It's also a good receiver. And once again, they've been able to go ahead and victimize this Arizona defense in a number of fashions. Minnick again on another touchdown run, showing the kind of second effort that made him the leading back. And Clarence Farmer, what a tremendous run here. Cutting across field, breaking tackles, and as I said, great peripheral vision in anticipation of where the defenders were at on the field. They just couldn't get him loose after that one. Johnny Jackson coming in, forcing that fumble, which resulted in another Arizona touchdown. And this is a nice catch by Bobby Wade deep down the field. He sold a short pattern, was able to take it down the field.
Well, we see the highlights, but I'll tell you what's telling. There is a statistic that we'll get into right now, and that is the Washington State Cougars know how to hang on to the football.
Well, they do, and what's the difference is they're not turning the football over. One thing that victimized this team last year was turnovers, and they've been able to hold on to the football.
All right, let's take a look at our first half statistics, and I think it'll bear it out, because I believe, like usual, they're hanging on to the ball about 45%.
If there's one thing that stands out, Dave, it's that time of possession. They totally dominated in terms of controlling the ball, long drives. That one drive alone was over 8 minutes. They ran, they passed on that drive, and they also are still leading in passing yards, but a lot of those were miscues early in the game by the Arizona offense in turning the football over, giving them the ball deep in their own possession.
Well, we saw a lot in the first half, so what do you think we might see in the second half?
I would expect to see exactly the same. This Washington State offensive team seems determined to try to score as many points as they can.
All right, we'll see if we can cut down on the turnovers and fumbles, etc., etc. All right, we got a whole half of football coming your way, so stick around. The Washington State Cougars and the Wildcats will be back on the field right after these timeout messages. Welcome back to Arizona Stadium, a scary place tonight. 8 touchdowns so far. Washington State's Cougars lead 35-21. Coming into the game, Messers, Gesser, and for the Wildcats, Johnson, were fairly well touted on both sides. Let's take a look at what they did tonight so far. Gesser, 11 of 21 with 2 touchdowns, 1 interception. Very much uncharacteristic so far. Jason Johnson, 9 of 16, but look at that right-hand column there. 3 interceptions tonight, and that's how Washington State picked up a couple of their scores, one directly and one indirectly from the turnovers. So Gesser, who threw the lights out in this building last year, comes back. He struggled a little bit in the first half. And the young man from St. Louis High School in Honolulu, Hawaii, just in his junior season, so we'll see.
Well, he's a winner too, Dave.
Back. Yep.
Yeah, go back to high school. He was 24-0 as a starter in high school. So this kid is accustomed to being a winner. And the other thing is, he makes everybody else around him play better.
Well, one more look at the Pac-10 scores final. Stanford over USC, 21-16. Oregon now distancing themselves from Utah State on the road, 38-21. And the Devils, 17-9 leaders over San Jose State. And in the other games of the Pac-10, UCLA defeated Oregon State, and And in the other game, Washington rallied to defeat California.
That's 2 weeks, 2 years in a row now that Cal jumped all over top of Washington, and they were able to pull it out in the fourth quarter.
But the Bears now 0-2 in league play after today. And the Wildcats heading back to the east sideline here at Arizona Stadium, where they have their work cut out for them, trailing by a score of 35-21 in a half of football that at best could be described as bizarre.
And you have to think that, you know, they're going to try to break that Pac-10 losing streak.
All right, Doug, let's check in with Dana Cooper. He has Coach Makovic standing by right now.
Coach, what happened in the first quarter, and then what needs to happen now to overcome the deficit?
We need to do now is we need to cut the deficit to 7 points or less by the end of the third quarter. Then we're in position to play the fourth quarter as well as we can and do what we have to do. We just were off to a bad start. That's the first time I've ever seen Jason in four games just put some balls. One was tipped, two were tipped, one was thrown right to him. But he settled down a little bit and played better after that.
When you looked the players in the eye in the locker room at halftime, did you like what you saw in their eyes?
Well, they're going to have to show it. Doesn't matter. The locker room doesn't count. This is the only thing counts is out here.
Good luck in the second half. All right, back upstairs, Doug and Dave.
Thank you very much, Dana. Well, he's got to make it count. Jason Johnson.
We were so accustomed to watching him accurately pass in those first few games that we became spoiled as broadcasters watching his efficiency out there in terms of finding the open receiver. But tonight, he struggled. There was a definite drop in his consistency in terms of throwing the football accurately to open receivers down the field.
Well, one other thing about that is just take a look at Dave Minnick. Understanding that both Washington State and Arizona were picked to be in the lower echelon of the conference this year. But remember, Arizona played two teams from the Mountain West Conference and Idaho. You don't see athletes like you have in the Pac-10. And that's what other clubs find out every year. Pac-10 athletes are bigger, faster, stronger. They've got a little bit better experience. And as a result, you're going to see that when you move into conference, anything can happen, as was the case with
right.
California.
Dave, don't you think also that these strategies, I'm really impressed with the sophistication of the offensive attack plans now that are taking place in the Pac-10. No more you see conservative run offenses. Usually they're spreading everybody out across the line of scrimmage, and you only need one or two of those big plays to go for touchdowns to change the complexion of a game.
Well, I think you'd be best to testify as we take a look at the kickoff here by Ryan Slack. This ball sails down. It's taken at the one. And the return is stuffed. Billy Newman, the strong safety from scrimmage, is met by his counterpart. And his counterparts, and that knockdown for the Wildcats on special teams is accomplished by Kirk Johnson.
Billy Newman was flagged in the first half for putting his helmet down. And it looks like a little bit of payback here by the Arizona defenders coming down on that kickoff. But special teams is where it's all about, just letting it all hang out. Give 100% effort, and if you're going to make a mistake, make sure you do it at full speed.
There's Kirk right there. Came down along with Jarvie Worcester. And the freshman makes a contribution here to begin the second half. Pitch to Minnick, and why not? He's been very effective tonight, but not on this first play to start the second half.
What makes Lance Briggs so valuable is not just his ability to tackle, but he gets off blocks. When you're a defensive personnel, you're supposed to defeat blocks and make sure that you get off them as quick as possible. Briggs that time, he was attempted to be blocked on the outside, but he basically just ran through the blocker and got to the ball carrier very quickly.
They gave Minnick a 1 yard gain, so second down and 9 at the 13-yard line. Guesser, on a look left. Throw nearly picked. It was a very good catch. Jermaine Chapman was there, and making the catch was Colin Henderson, who, by the way, attended the same high school in Washington as Jason Johnson. So they know each other. And Colin Henderson's dad, Jerry, a standout quarterback a generation ago at Washington State. He was a pretty good high school athlete, three-time football, basketball, and baseball letterman. At Puyallup, Washington in high school. Give. Near side, it's Minnick. Minnick is dragged down by several, including Brandon Nash and Keone Frazier. And they mark him down for maybe a loss of a half yard. Second down and 10.
when Keone Frazier gets started, there's not much you can do to stop him. Look at that weak effort by Bush, number five, their wide receiver, Mike Bush, coming in trying to make a block, but Dave Minnick had nowhere to go. He was quickly wrapped up in the backfield, and credit the Arizona defense with quickly getting to the perimeter.
Mr. Bush thinking more of setting a screen than laying a block. Second down and 10 for Washington State and Gesser. Big tumble block by Minnick, and the ball is squirted away down the field, and it's caught. It is caught. My goodness, Jerome Riley flying down the sideline, and he beat Jermaine Chapman. That was quite a throw and quite a catch.
People only see the end of the play, but it's what happens back in the backfield that what is what make plays available. Good protection that time. David Minnick just upends one of the Arizona defenders, giving Jason Gesser an opportunity. Austin Ukut coming in on a blitz, but that was a fade pattern. What I mean by fade is you'll notice how Riley drifted to the outside at the very end, giving himself an opportunity to make that catch. He had 100 yards receiving in last week's game against Cal.
And on that play, Chapman giving up about 4 inches to Riley. Big, tall receiver. Here's Gesser again. He's going to dump it out of bounds. The catch was made by Nakoa McAlrath. And that will bring up a second down for Washington State. And you heard just a moment ago when Dana Cooper was speaking to John Makovic that the Wildcats had to get within 7, and they don't need to go down by 21 again. So somebody here on the Arizona defense is going to need to make a big play.
But there's two big series at the end of the first half and also this beginning of the second half. But look at what they've done on McElrath tonight. Only one catches. This guy was leading the Pac-10 in receptions, receiving yards, and also in terms of the nation. I think he had number one receiving yards in the entire country.
Give it to Minnick off the left tackle. And again, the good blocks of Locker, Parrish, and Hunt open it up for him. And he has picked up about 6 yards. He'll bring up third down and 4. It was Austin Uku who got to return the favor after that big block a moment ago.
We'll see this play as David Minnick seeing it. You'll see that he's patiently waiting for his blockers to try to find some sort of a hole. He just basically tried to stay behind his offensive line. And when you talk to Mike Price, the difference between last year's team and this one, it was his confidence and how excited he was about that offensive line.
Third down for Washington State and Dave Minnick. And don't be surprised if they go to him again. Instead, it's a quick toss across the middle, and wide open is Henderson. And the flanker screen works. Michael Jolivet made the stop. I beg your pardon. I thought it was Colin Henderson, number 83. As you know now, it's Jeremy Thielber, number 33. That's his second reception of the night.
You'll see Thielber, he just basically fakes like he's going to give a block and then just slips off the outside. This is the second time now that we've seen him run this same identical play on this offense, and it's totally catching Arizona by surprise.
The ball is at the 13, so Washington State could conceivably pick up a first down before possibly scoring. Give. Minnick across the 10, down at the 8-yard line. And I'll tell you what, this is a very good offensive line exhibited tonight by the Cougars.
They're executing on the line of scrimmage in terms of getting blocks. They're giving him Gesser protection. That's on this drive, Gesser has completed 5 in a row and 8 of his last 9 passes. And when you mix that with the running of David Minnick and the determination, you can see what's happening on this drive.
Cougars spread all over the field, give it to Minnick, off right side, off the guard issue that time. The Wildcats trying to grab the football, but you're not going to get it away from that former Marine. Not easily anyway. It'll bring up a third down for Washington State. Keone Frazier is credited with the stop of Minnick. Minnick, 6 foot, 221 pound senior. And he took a cut. He's got an eye.
Yeah, it looks like someone did a Three Stooges on him. Poked him in the eye.
Well, he's out. Replacing him is Alan Thompson. Third down and 4 for Washington State. Hillbar in motion, sets at the tight end. Quick look. It's to Mike Bush, and it's knocked away. and they were hoping they could take advantage of the height difference. Michael Jolivet, number 8, he's 5'9". Mike Bush, he is 6'6", and it was Jolivet who was able to make the stab at the ball and knock it away.
Michael Jolivet waited patiently, and we talked about his sense of timing when the ball is in the air. He times this perfectly. He gets one hand up. He doesn't have to get two because he knows that he can't get two, both of his hands as high as Bush can. All he needs to do is knock the ball away.
Don't forget about Colin Henderson to hold. Drew Dunning is 6 of 6 inside 30, and he is now 7 of 7 on the season inside 30 yards. So Drew Dunning puts three more aboard. Now the Cougars lead it 38-21, and Minnick is being fixed. Welcome back to Arizona Stadium. The Wildcats trail 38-21. You see Dave Minnick on the sideline and wonder why he might be out of business for a couple of minutes.
Well, number 47, Jarvie Wooster, comes in from the left side of the screen, and you'll see he puts his hand right through the face mask of David Minnick, and he obviously caught him in the eye socket. That's why Minnick is on the sideline with so much discomfort. You see Wooster coming in, trying to make an effort of swiping at the running back's helmet and face gear. They're trying to do anything they can to get this Dave Minnick on the ground.
The Cougars kicked the ball to the Wildcats, and it is taken on a knee by Gary Love. And Arizona begins, as they had so many times in the first half, with the ball at the 20-yard line.
Makes such a huge difference when your offense has to be able to sustain drives of 50 yards or more. And they've consistently put themselves in situations where they've had to go 80 yards because of the kicking of Washington State.
Well, you saw the scoring drive that time, 11 plays. And
those are monster drives. And that's one thing that Mike Price really prided himself on this season, with was his offense being able to sustain those long drives.
Well, the Wildcats will need to run and to throw to sustain one now. Johnson with a pump fake, in trouble. And he's going to be knocked down at the 15-yard line. That is what you call a coverage sack.
Bobby Wade was out in the flat, but he was double covered. He had two defenders on him, and Jason Johnson thought initially that he might go ahead and try to dump the ball out to Bobby Wade. But rather than risk trying to throw an interception, he decided just to try to stay alive. And I'm sure he's just in desperation here. Now what am I going to do with it?
Well, this is a product of the Cougars' defense coming in, and we'll get to that after this second down play, second and 15. And this play goes very little. That's Farmer, and he's run down by Ronald Smith. But the Cougars, in the first three games of the season, had allowed just 199 net yards rushing, 74 to the Idaho Vandals, 54 by the Boise Broncos, and 71 by a Pac-10 team, California, last week. If you look at Clarence Farmer with 68 yards. Well, tonight, Arizona now, still well under 100. They've only got about 80 or some odd yards on the ground tonight. They're going to need to improve on that. On third down and long, Johnson with time, fires up high and wide open is Andre Thurman. Tell you what, he was the Maytag guy there for a minute. That ball hung up in the air a long time, and the Cougars could close, but he was all alone in the middle of the field.
That ball, I think what happened was Jason Johnson did not want another incompletion, and he knew that he had Thurman wide open down the middle of the field and decided, I'm just going to go for the completion rather than a touchdown, allow Thurman the opportunity to make this catch.
And he did. And the Wildcats have a first down inside Cougar territory. First down for Arizona. The ball spotted on the 43-yard line. Five catches now for Andre Thurman as Bobby Wade, number one, goes into motion. A little misdirection, plenty of time for Johnson, and then all of a sudden they come and break it. That was Ryan Long. And I tell you what, you expected the block to be made, but he makes a big play. 6'6", 287 pound, and he's just a sophomore.
What happens is the reason why this ball wasn't thrown, nobody's open. You can see Bobby Wade downfield, well covered that time.
by two defenders, and Jason Johnson looked like he was initially going to wind up and throw it downfield, but all of his receivers were well covered.
And Long just ran around Stephen Grace and put the hurt on Johnson. Arizona back in their own side of the field. Johnson on second down and Long stays in the pocket, over the middle, and nearly picked. It was thrown somewhat near Bobby Wade, but hit the grass, and that man started things tonight for Washington State. Lamont Thompson, you might recall if you're with us, he's the one who picked off the pass that started the game and scored a touchdown.
Well, part of the composure of being a quarterback is that you have to be able to perform not just when your team's ahead, but when your team is behind. And Jason Johnson struggling tonight. What, 9 of 17 passes, 3 interceptions, and only 1 touchdown?
Well, you might recall they got off to a wobbly start in San Diego as well and had to come back. Third down. Johnson's going to air it out again. He's looking for Thurman again, and it's in and out of his hands. Oh, boy. So close. I believe it was Billy Newman who thought he had it.
It was.
And then he gave it toward Andre Thurman, who thought he had it.
Billy Newman was mad at himself because the ball coming down, he thought that he was going to just make an easy catch. What a great shot down there by our camera guys. But then the ball deflected off of Newman, and Thurman had an opportunity unexpectedly at the last second to come down with that catch, but I think it just caught him by surprise.
Well, no surprise. Now on fourth and forever, Ramey Peru onto the field. It's fourth and 21 for Arizona. And at the other end of this will be Collins. Peru's kick, high spiral. And the fair catch called, and a penalty. And I think they're saying the Wildcats, again, did not leave enough room. That was Colin Henderson and the Wildcat on the play. And I believe it was number 60, Thomas Stevens. Let's take one more look. There's Henderson. He's called the fair catch and runs. I don't think so.
I don't know. That looked like a flyover that time by one of the Arizona defenders.
The receiver was on the ground when the offensive player entered the 2-yard belt. Therefore, there was no foul.
Attaboy.
Yes, there we go.
There was a reserve linebacker, Ben Dalmolin. And Ben, just as you appropriately described it, a flyover. That's a new one for the lexicon, folks, the flyover. But we've got more here. We're flying high, 7:43 to go in the third.
Gila River.
There's some jumping, yelling, and screaming going on here tonight at the stadium, and you can get involved as well. The Cats next week have the Oregon Ducks here. You can get involved by calling 621-CATS. That's the McHale Ticket Office, or check it out at www.arizcats.com. Don't miss it out here. You will not be bored, and perhaps you'll want to wear a shirt. Whatever. or paint your body if you're not going to wear a shirt. Here's Gesser on first down. The big, long throw, and that's going to be picked off. No, drop by Jarvie Worcester, and he's going to want that one back. However, there is a flag in the backfield of Washington State about the place where you'd expect a hold call. And that's exactly what we get.
There's usually a reason why players are put on defense. And Jarvie Worcester just showed us why. Many times defenders just don't quite have the touch as far as pulling balls in.
Eek.
And I have to say mine were just exactly like Jarvie's.
Holy.
There.
On the offense. 10-yard penalty, previous spot, still first down.
I never thought much about interceptions. It was always, let me hit the receiver. Yeah, that was the fun stuff.
Mr. Cecil was like that
as well.
Oh,
no, Chuck. Chuck, he goes into out of body when you start talking about it. He becomes another person. It's a transformation.
And you're not too far behind. I'm watching your face right now. There's my
boy,
Chucky.
That's it.
Coach of the Tennessee Titans. All right, now the Wildcat defense with an opportunity on first and 20. It's a draw play and a trip in the backfield. Not a knockdown, it's Dave Minnick. In case you're scoring this bout, that was a slip, not a knockdown.
Washington State, about the only thing they haven't been doing very well tonight is their penalty situations. They piled up six penalties for 44 yards. And give credit to the Wildcats. They might not have played well early in this football game, but they've only been victimized for two penalties for 15 yards.
All right, that brings up second down and 19 after the big play. Matt Molina made the stop on that previous play. Now a throw out in the flat, and that bounces off the hands of the intended receiver. And that's Nikoa McElrath.
Did he must have stayed up last night and watched the late movie or something. This guy, it's hard to believe that he's the leading receiver in the Pac-10 with the way he's played tonight. Yes, I understand Arizona's defense has maybe roughed him up a little bit, but we've seen situations tonight, Dave, where he's just flat not wanted the football.
And that will add up as the night progresses. All right, third and 19. Gesser can do it. Play action fake. Throw it out of the backfield, bobbled, caught, and the hit is made. The receiver was Mark Baldwin. He's the reserve tight end. That's his third catch of the year. Lance Briggs and Clay Hart combined to make the play, the stop, and guess what? The Arizona defense holds. They'll get the ball back.
Well, Mike Price likes that Mark Baldwin because of his size. He's 6'5", 248, and usually the average yards per catch is much less for a tight end. But he had a 13-yard average coming into tonight's game. And again, it's because of, just like Arizona's offense, spreading the football around and not just strictly concentrating on the wide receivers.
.6:39 to go in the third. And once again, Alan Cox on the field. And we have a little chit-chat now amongst the referees. Cox has been averaging just under 40 tonight.
You know, one of the big differences in tonight's game, we've seen receivers on both teams catch balls, and especially Arizona in the past, as many as 9 receivers in a game. Well, that's all changed tonight. There's only been 3 players that have a catch for Arizona. But for Washington State, it's 7 different players. So they're doing a much better job of distributing the football around.
All right, Mr. Cox is being protected by his group. Standing at the 30-yard line on the other end of the field is one Bobby Wade. Arizona bringing everybody for the block, and he just gets it away and fires a spiral. Wade takes it at the 25 and gets away to the 30. He needs a blocker or two. He's out to the 38-yard line where he's knocked down by several Cougars in pursuit. I believe one of them was Siren Morong, reserve linebacker. However, the Wildcats get the football. They trail this game 38-21. And this is just game 4 for the Wildcats. A quick look at upcoming matches. We talked about the Oregon Ducks coming here next week, and they had a little bit of a Donnybrook against Utah State. In Utah, Oregon State will be a road opponent, and then the Washington Huskies, the SoCal Trojans will be the next team here after that, and then the month of November, Arizona has Stanford here on the 10th. Play action on one, and this is a long bomb intended for the wide receiver Gary Love, and the speedster cannot hang on. We'll bring up a second down and 10. Jason David with him step for step that time.
That was pretty good coverage that time by Washington State down in secondary, but you'll see he looks like he had an opportunity to make that catch. It came right between both of his hands. And Johnson that time, those are the kind of throws, but it looks as though one of the Cougar defenders comes in at the last second with his arm and is able to knock that ball loose.
Well, the Cats trailing by 17 now in the third. They got to make a move soon. Farmer trying to make that move right now. A dance and a spin, and that's our best run of the second half. A 9-yard pickup on second down. It'll make it third and 1. Lamont Thompson from the free safety spot came in to make the stop.
Clarence Farmer is able to run over defenders, but what he does best, you see him high-stepping there, getting through the line of scrimmage, then doing a pirouette. But Lamont Thompson kept in his wide base and was able to wrap him up and still make the tackle.
Farmer now honing in on the 100-yard mark. He's got 78 in the book so far. Third down and short. Leo Mills, the lone setback. It's going to be a quick out to Bobby Wade, and Wade stays on his feet. and drags a couple of Cougars into their own territory. First down at the 46-yard line. And it was Billy Newman and Ryanel Smith who got a ride aboard Bobby Wade.
Bobby Wade, he's known for his ability to make yards after the catch. And despite having three defenders over there, he is able to elude the first defender. But unfortunately, pursuit comes over and is able to wrap him up. And Bobby Wade, other than that one touchdown, he's been somewhat contained, much like McElrath, their key receiver.
Johnson now 11 of 21 on the night for 173 yards. First down. Bootleg, and they read it. Fadeaway pass, that's trouble, and it might be caught. It is. Sometimes you need fortunes and good fortunes. And that time the Wildcats get one. They pick up a break as the ball dribbled, dropped, and went around. And finally ended up in the hands of Steve Fleming for his first catch of the year. And he'll remember that one.
I remember Steve Fleming. Wasn't he a former quarterback in high school? But he's tall. He's able to reach out, get a hold of this football. Look, he stays with it. Instead of just ignoring it, he's able to make the catch.
And a big catch. And right straight through the middle. A big tackle made on Farmer. And that was made by Lamont Thompson. And that was a saving tackle. And we've got a little chat. Now watch here. Farmer with the good step. That was it. Lamont Thompson doesn't get him. He may go all the way.
Well, Lamont Thompson, if he had not made this tackle, Farmer could very well have gone the distance. He was breaking to the outside and he had a running lane. But Lamont Thompson has played very well tonight. He's been doing a nice job on pass coverage as well as making tackles.
All right, Farmer had enough for the first down. The ball is spotted at the 32. That's good enough for the first down, but let's see if the Cougars have a late penalty against them or if this is something that occurred in play and the Wildcats will decline. If it's a procedural call, the Wildcats no doubt will decline and take the first down. And Mike Price asking his defense to step up right now, knowing that he has a chance to end some frustration in this series if you're a Washington State fan.
Offside on the defense. 5 yards was gained on the play. Penalty is refused.
There you go. Arizona already had the first down. Farmer now with 83 yards on 15 carries, and that an important first down. 4 minutes, 26 seconds remain in the third. Arizona trails by 17, 38-21. And if you just joined us, Arizona spotted Washington State a 28-0 lead to begin the game. Split backs. And somebody moved. And I believe Arizona is going to give it 5 yards. And that's good. You have a kid like Stephen Grace who kept with the snap count at center. He wasn't going to give it up. There you go.
That's embarrassing a quarterback when you forget the own snap count. The only thing worse than that is when you walk up the line of scrimmage and put your hands underneath the guard.
Yeah. And I've seen that.
That beats them all. That's especially the look on the guard's face when he turns around. What are you doing?
You trying to get milk out of here, boy? Arizona has just 3 flags tonight, and none of them majors. All right, now on first and 15, the ball at the 37-yard line. Johnson straight back with time, going to air it out, looking for Andre Thurman, a jump and a down, and no flag, incomplete pass. That was Eric Coleman, the safety, who was back with Andre.
Jason's feeling good vibes tonight for Andre Thurman. The success he's had on throwing some long balls to him tonight, I think he feels like, hey, I'm going to just throw this thing out here, and Thurman's going to be able to come down with it. But this Washington State team has improved dramatically. Their ability to rush the passer, stop the run, and their coverage downfield, they've made a dramatic turnaround.
Second down and 15 again at the 37. Johnson in a lot of trouble, and the ball gets away. And will Mills pick it up, yes or no? Finally, the Wildcats cover it at the 40-yard line. Oh, boy.
Wildcats did a very poor job. Leo Mills that time is the one that actually missed the block that allowed this play to take place. And Jeremy Williams, number 95, comes hard from the outside. And one thing that this defense has done this year, they've stepped it up speed-wise on the outside. They've brought in speed rushers. You can see him run right by Leo Mills. That was number 9, Isaac Brown, actually. Used to be a linebacker. They stick him out at defensive end now. Extremely quick coming off the corner.
Third down now, 18 for the Wildcats. 3:10 to go in the third. Johnson chased. Has Wade out of the backfield, drags across, and he is brought down at the 37-yard line. That's well short of a first down. And we'll see what the Wildcats want to do at the 37. You bring in Ramey Peru to try to pooch it into the corner, or do you take a stab at it?
Very difficult trying to convert on third and 20 yards. The defense hangs back. They'll give you the shorter routes. And what happens is they have so many players outnumbering your receivers 20 yards downfield. You have no other choice but to go ahead and throw it short and hope that that receiver will get a first down.
Ramey Peru will attempt to put this ball down in the corner or kick it so high that everybody else could get underneath it. Waiting for it once again is Colin Henderson. And he's going to send it very high to the middle of the field. Henderson fields it at the 15 and hangs on. So the Cougars have the ball again late in the third quarter. 2:13 to go. They lead Arizona 38-21. These Cougars have more tackle football ahead of them this season. They got Oregon State at home next up, next week, at Stanford, a bye Oregon, then UCLA, Arizona State, and the Big Apple game on November 17 against the Huskies. On first down after the punt, and a big mob. And at the bottom of it, it's Allen. No, it's Lavelle Anderson with a carry tonight. He's just a freshman out of San Diego, California. Anthony Thomas, Arizona's tackle, made the play.
I was thinking of those upcoming games. Better to have Oregon at home. Don't they have a 23 home game streak going for them right now? Not a fun place to play.
Autzen Stadium, no, in Arizona. I'll tell you what, you'll find out, Doug, as you watch this club. Arizona does not like that place. Second down play, the catch showing blitz. Guesser gets away. And it's Gary Love in contain and drops him. Or make that Johnny Jackson. You keep forgetting that Arizona now has two nines. It gets you once in a while. They got offensive nines and defensive nines, and obviously that's the defensive nine, the senior Johnny Jackson. You show this great contain here. He'll just set himself out there and say, I dare you to come anywhere near me.
Johnny Jackson has been a terror these last couple weeks, sacking the quarterback, and look how he just viciously goes after tackles. This guy, he loves to play football.
That's the guy you want on the field. All right. Guesser, minus 18 yards and 7 carries. Let's see how he throws here in this key situation. And there's a flag. It's Jermaine Chapman's man. And it was Colin Henderson with the catch. And you figure that Guesser and the Cougars will have a first down regardless of the outcome of the flag decision, and they do.
One of the things that defensive backs forget, once the ball is thrown, you should go back to the ball, run towards the ball where the quarterback is standing, because many times the receivers will come right back. You see, he's shielded off that time, but instead of coming back, he actually stands there and waits for the football to arrive. Jermaine Chapman that time, who is going to be flagged, you can see his left hand, and he just basically jumps on the back, hoping that he'll cause the incompletion.
Pass interference on the defense, automatic first down, spot of foul.
It's not easy, though. It's easy for us to stand up here in the press box and give the right technique. I can assure you it's much more difficult when you're down on the field trying to take away the inside, the outside, shallow, deep. It's a difficult job.
Well, on the penalty, the automatic first down, and quite frankly, not much of a switch. It was about a 10-yard play anyway, so the net yardage is about right. So first down at the 28-yard line for Guesser and the company. And somebody wasn't there. Guesser, bootleg, runs out to the side. I think he was expecting that his tailback was going to be ready for a toss sweep. That would have been Minnick. They're going to chat now. He wasn't there.
That's what makes it very difficult when you're trying to game plan teams that you're playing against. This happens throughout the football game. Players run in the wrong direction. Look at Jason Gesser turning around. Hey, I'm not supposed to be back here by myself. But he's got enough mobility. He had a little bit of whiplash there in his neck. But that was certainly somebody making a mental mistake on that play.
Matt Molina and Shelton Ross picked him up that time. Second down, 26 seconds remain in the third quarter. Gesser stands at the 21-yard line. He's going after Mike Bush and Bush, and that's going to produce the hanky. Michael Jolivet did all that he could. And I tell you what, that is a heads-up play by Jolivet, because if Bush catches that, he's gonzo. Instead, it'll be a 10-yard penalty.
What do you think, Dave? Is that a catchable ball? I guess they're going to rule it, so.
At this point in time, I don't think you want to take the chance.
Yeah, it's harder to run with two people, one guy on your back, than it is by yourself. As you said, though, to risk leaving a receiver open for what could be a sure touchdown, that is definitely a preferential move to interfere with the wide receiver and only get a penalty, an interference penalty in college, is not nearly as severe as it is in the NFL.
No, and quite frankly, Michael Jolivet, we know, is a very capable young athlete, but at the same time, he's giving up nearly a foot of height to Michael Bush. So when Bush gets by him, there's very little he can do.
And even if the ball, even if you have great coverage and you're right there with him and the ball's coming down, a 6'6 basketball player probably is going to have more probability of coming down with the ball than you are.
Now, the Wildcats had been doing a good job about staying away from penalties, but that's not the case now, as Minnick just busts, barrels, knocks his way for a 4-yard gain. And he is out of bounds with 14 seconds remaining in the third quarter. Washington State with the only score, much to the chagrin of that young man, the young cat, a field goal here in the third, and they've got a 17-point lead, 38-21.
Football is about being tough, having a good attitude, and you're seeing why Washington State was so successful this year. Last week against Cal, that score was 16-13 at halftime. They scored 35 points in the second half, basically just dominated Cal, and it's because of their mental toughness.
Second down, give to Minnick, big hole. Minnick is close to and spins, and he will have the first down. Boy, he is as tough, a big, strong kid. We came into the ball game, Ray Wells making the stop on this former Marine. You start to wonder, boot camp, a little bit more difficult than full camp,
especially for the Marines.
Yep.
This guy has been through the staying out, sleeping outside with no sleeping bag, bugs crawling on him.
Yep.
Yeah, drinking mud water, all that good stuff. Football is a piece of cake to him.
Yeah, that's not much for Marine. That's just little stuff. They'll get some back teen out.
Cut it off.
All right. We have completed three quarters of tackle football here at the stadium tonight, and the home team trails because of this guy, Dave Minnick and his friends, 38-21 the score. As far as the scoreboard goes, it's a depleting asset right now. They scored a lot in the first, only 14 in the second. In the third, they were down to three. But Arizona needs 17. That is just to tie as we begin the fourth quarter here at Arizona Stadium. 38-21, the Cougars, and Jason Gesser with the big lead, along with this guy, Dave Minnick. And from the halls of Montezuma to the floor of Arizona Stadium. He is...
That just rolled right off your tongue, Dave. That sounded like you belong on a plaque.
Well, we don't have any shores here, you might...
This guy's done it all. He's ran the ball very well. He's been patient, refuses to go down, never lets the first tackler drag him down by himself. Those are pretty impressive. I talked about his versatility before the game even started, and that really indicates it right there. Another 100-yard rushing game. That's a sixth in his career. He's also a nice receiver coming out of the backfield.
Well, in every one of the games between these two schools, somebody emerges as a hero, and tonight it's Dave Minnick. Way deep drop at the 50. Gesser in trouble. Knocked down there. Lance Briggs was in on the stop, and I believe he got some assistance from his friend Brandon Nash. That's a big play.
Brandon Nash has been all over this field tonight, but so has Lance Briggs, playing special teams, making tackles on punt returns. Lance Briggs was leading the Pac-10 in solo tackles. You'll see that he keeps Gesser from getting rid of the ball because he jumped up in the throwing lane, was able to buy himself some additional time, and he must have tremendous hand strength to be able to grab the quarterback at that angle and hold on.
Well, that play sets up a third and 14. The ball moved back to the 49-yard line. Gesser on the draw play. And squirting through is the freshman Anderson, but not enough. Clay Hart and Brandon Nash make the stop for Arizona, and the punt squad coming onto the field. That means Alan Cox again, and again it was Nash.
Brandon Nash did a nice job of recognizing the play and getting back into the running lane. He was actually on the outside, and he recognized the draw play, and he was able to scrape down the line of scrimmage and help on that tackle.
Cox, who was an all-world punter before he came to Washington State up at Snow College, junior college, and he fires this one. It should hit the end zone. Wade gets out of the way, and it dribbles under the blue part of Arizona Stadium. So Arizona, for the umpteenth time, begins at the 20. Tell you what, that Washington State kicking game should get a little gold star tonight.
It has. What a tremendous difference in execution. Being able to totally nullify any type of kickoff returns, as well as their punt coverage. They do a nice job on hang time by their punter. We saw that onside kick also, where the kicker was actually involved in knocking that ball loose on that onside kick return effort.
Now, there's your star of the night so far, the former Marine. And Arizona, meanwhile, runs the ball, and it gets back to the line of scrimmage on first down. That brings up second down for the Wildcats.
David Minnick may be investing in one of those clear shields for his helmet on the next game.
Yeah.
With everybody trying to poke his eyes out, because they're not having much luck doing anything else trying to get him down on the ground. But it's determination. There's a lot of running backs that are his size, his strength, his speed. But it's what he has inside that makes the difference.
Meanwhile, for Arizona, they did pick up one with Farmer on that first play. So second down and nine, and Johnson in big trouble. And you get the sense right now, Doug, that Arizona needs to make a change right now in terms of their body language, in terms of the momentum, in terms of getting back into this game. 11:49 to go.
So many times the offensive line, when they're in pass protection, as soon as the ball is snapped, they start backing up with their feet. And what happens is they tramp on the toes of the quarterback trying to drop back into his protection. And that time he actually had one of his toes tramped on by one of his linemen.
Yeah, this will be a significant third down play for the Wildcats. 14 to go. They're bringing everybody. Johnson is belted, and he gets the ball in and out of the hands. And I'm pretty sure it was Malosi Leonard. Oh, my goodness. That was a heck of a throw by Johnson. And if you have a youngster at home who thinks it's great to be a quarterback all the time, how about this?
I don't know what's worse, being the quarterback on this play or the receiver, but that will definitely... You'll feel this the next morning, because these are blind shots. You're looking down the field, and these are just free runs by defenders coming in, trying to wreak their havoc on the quarterback.
All right, Colin Henderson stands on the 45 waiting for Peru's kick, a wobbly affair. It's going to bounce, and it's going to take an Arizona bounce out of bounds at the 49-yard line of Washington State. However, the clock has run some more. 11:15 to go, and that's it. 38-21, the Wildcats trail. He wants you. Uncle Sam wants you to join the Wildcats and their fans. Three more home games, including Oregon next week. Call 621-CATS for ticket information. Get them on the web at www.arizonacats.com. Joining Uncle Sam tonight in the crowd is Dana Cooper. Dana.
Dave, this game last year Arizona affected both team seasons in a pretty significant way, and we'll tell the story after this play unfolds.
Yeah, it's an old story to Dave Minnick. Another nice run off the right tackle, Dana.
Dave, Arizona was 5-1 going into the Washington State game last year, which they won 56 or 53 to 47 in triple overtime. That was the last win of the season for Arizona. They lost the next six games and finished 5-6. For Washington State, it marked a downturn in their season as well, and they lost four games that year, three of them in overtime. And one of Mike Price's big goals was to correct this deficit in close games. And so far, they're enjoying a 17-point lead tonight.
And they're doing it now, Dana, in just smash mouth style. That is Alan Thompson spelling Dave Minnick for just a play or two. And the Cougars now are moving the chains on the ground, Doug. And Arizona needs to build a dam right now.
They certainly do, and they need to go ahead and gain momentum back. They had it for a while in the second quarter, but they let it slip away. And I think Washington State is trying to just gear down the energy level of this game, and they're trying to pull Arizona with them, trying to get into more conservative play calling and just let the time be more of a factor.
Yes, sir. Big hit at the line of scrimmage. Again, Alan Thompson gets the call for the Cougars, and he moved, maybe a yard. And that'll bring up a third down and 9 for Washington State.
It's amazing that game last year that Arizona won in the triple overtime, how even those teams were. And when you look at even statistically, both teams that night gained exactly 490 yards. That's the game guesser, of course, threw the 6 touchdowns in, but he had turnovers. It was the 5 turnovers which haunted them last year, which they have not been able to go ahead and provide Arizona this year.
All right, Gesser on second and long. Mick tosses it out. It's complete. And that's the McAlrath. And he picks up enough for the first down. Well, you were talking about the last game they played here and the turnovers. That's exactly how it ended last year. McAlrath looking down. This is in triple overtime. And the pickoff was made. And that's how it ended last year in 3 overtimes. And, of course, 2 years ago, Arizona up in Pullman stole a game from them as Bobby Wade. Then
no, that was a good catch.
Well, it came down with the ball. And that's the way it went in the book.
There's no replay in NCAA.
That's right. Well, it was good enough for the first down on the previous play. And I believe Minnick is back up to his work ethic. Well, you make the call one more time. This is 1999 on the Palouse.
I give him the catch because he's excited afterwards. He's more excited than anybody else on the field after he comes off the turf. That looks like the real deal.
Yep. Well, we called it a touchdown. That so it was said, so it should be written. Yeah, Bobby came in and wore different numbers, Doc. There's a lot of different numbers in this program all the time. Farmer had a different number before 32. Briggs, as a matter of fact, wore 32 and then gave it up to Farmer, and that's why he now wears 27. The big number now for Arizona is second down, and they need to make a big play. Gesser turns around, throws to the end zone, out of bounds, and no flag. And I imagine if you're a Wildcat fan, the number that's most important is at the top center of your screen. 8 minutes, 29 seconds remain, final quarter play. And Arizona needs 17 just to put it into overtime.
Jason Gesser coming into tonight's game throwing about 52% completion. He's right on target tonight. He's completed 16 out of 30 for 266 yards, which is way down from the effort he had last week against Cal, over 400 yards.
Big third down play. Toss it out. Nobody there. And now a penalty flag. If it's against Arizona, that might be the knockout punch. And the Cougars are behaving as if it is. It's a hold. It's against Arizona. That's an automatic first down. And with needing 3 scores, you wonder. Anthony Thomas has been accused of holding, and he has been convicted by a jury of referees.
Is that why he was in the middle of our screen?
Holding,
yep.
On the defense, prior to the pass being thrown, 10-yard penalty previous spot, automatic first down.
What makes their offense so efficient is that the quarterback does not drop straight back very many times. He's always sprinting out. It's a moving pocket. And what happens is when you're a defensive lineman or a linebacker,
you get tired of chasing the quarterback because you're not going to the same spot every time. Sometimes Gesser rolls to the right, to the left. He is always moving, and as the game goes on, the energy level of the defense has a tendency to drop because they just get tired.
Single setback is Minnick. They give it to him. He dives on the left side. Arizona's defense stops him, but watch that clock. 8:15 remain. Kirk Johnson, by the way, made the stop on that play. And you see Minnick and company in no hurry whatsoever to get back in a huddle and call another play.
These are the times where it's important to have a fired up, enthusiastic coach, but someone on the field has to be the leader. Someone has to tell the other players, this is where it's going to stop. We're going to turn this thing around. We're going to not let them have any more yards. Coach can't do that.
Second down and 8. Toss sweep. And they just belt it right forward again. Minnick picked up another 3 or 4 yards, but more importantly, that took another half a minute off the clock.
Arizona piling up more penalties here in the second half. Now they have 6 penalties tied with Washington State. But David Minnick, they're wearing this guy out tonight. But he seems to be up for the task. He continually runs the ball with some authority, always looking for that extra yard.
Well, for the Wildcats now, it's minute by minute. And for the Cougars, it's minute by minute.
30 carries for over 100 yards. That's a big night.
Now they sweep it around the right side. Allen Thompson, and there's a flag on the field. The good news for Arizona, there's a possibility it's against Washington State. That stops the clock.
Oh, this is going to go against the Cougars because two of their linemen thought that they were on defense that time, and they tackled two of the Arizona defenders as they were coming through the middle. You can see some of the takedowns.
10-yard penalty, previous spot, still third down.
Oh, you're right. That's a good way to
Sam Lightbody, he looked like he was in a rodeo.
Big old Josh Parrish there. Now, he needs to be fed a couple times a day. 6'6", 296 pounds, and moms and dads, he's just a sophomore. He's going to grow one boy.
And that's the difference between Washington State this year and past years. They were generally 20, 30 pounds lighter. There's Larry McDuff, defense coordinator, trying to improvise here and keep this team, this Cougar offense, out of the end zone one more time. But Mike Price said that the guys that he has now on those offensive and defensive lines are the same size as his competition. And he feels real good about the Pac-10 season along the lines of scrimmage.
Well, don't discount the possibility of a wild play, because that's the way these two teams play. Until then, Mike Bush runs a simple post pattern, finds a seam, Gesser finds him, and the Cougars are now knocking on the door to put this one away.
You can see Mike Bush coming over, letting his right arm just hang down. He's in a little bit of pain. Lance Briggs came over and made a heck of a hit after he made that catch. You can hear the sound effects.
The sound hurts of a stinger.
You know what? I'll tell you what. He's the toughest basketball player I've ever met.
Yeah. First and goal, and another belt at the line of scrimmage, and the play was ruled dead prior to the fumble. The Wildcats all claim it's theirs, but instead it's a touchdown for Washington State.
It's about keeping possession of the football as it crosses the plane of the end zone. Now, it can be knocked out afterwards, but as long as the ball is in possession, when it crosses that white line, it's a touchdown.
Minnick with the spin, he's got it. It's a touchdown. Drew Dunning, very good with his conversion kicks tonight. And that's another point for Washington State. And with 6 touchdowns and a field goal, they now lead it 45-21. Well, Minnick again. Hey, it's late September. That means Major League Baseball, the pennant race is red hot, and the Diamondbacks will try to move one step closer to the playoffs tomorrow afternoon against the Dodgers. So they beat 8-1 today. Catch all the action live from Bank One Ballpark right here on Southern Arizona Sports Leader. Game time, 1:30 tomorrow, right here on Arizona's WB58 Cable 8, the Dodgers and the Diamondbacks. And the Dodgers are just about done. The Giants are left, and the Wildcats take it out of the end zone, and I believe that's Mr. Love. Gary Love, the sophomore, brings it out, and he has stopped well short of the 20-yard line. Arizona goes to work at the 16, and you can sense Washington State is feeling that they've undone a lot of disappointment they've had in this series most recently. They lost them at home a couple of years ago on a controversial catch last year, the triple overtime. Let's take one look at Mr. Minnick's most recent touchdown. Scoring drive, 11 plays. Cliff Watkins now the quarterback for the Wildcats. He goes to Melosi Leonard, and he's knocked out of bounds. That is Melosi's first catch of the night.
Unbelievable. One of the leading receivers coming into tonight's game with Bobby Wade, 14 catches, and waiting till the fourth quarter to have his first reception. Talking of baseball, how about Barry Bonds hit number 69? I love the dive for the ball out in the water. That was better than the game.
If Padre pitchers would figure out if you throw the ball down and away, no one has to go in the water and get wet and risk their lives. They don't want to get pneumonia out there in that thing. Cliff Watkins going to go deep this time, and that is going to be going the other way. It's picked off by the safety, Billy Newman. So after catching Leonard the first time, Watkins, who came into the ballgame 2 of 6, throws his first interception of the season. The fourth interception of the night for Washington State. And will just about to do it.
This turnover situation is almost exactly opposite of what took place last year, which what enabled Arizona to win that football game was turnovers. And unfortunately for them tonight, they were a victim of their own turnovers, their own self-caused created turnovers early in the first quarter, which really they were fighting back from just within the first few minutes of this football game.
Well, it's the longest trip in the Pac-10, Tucson to Pullman, and the visiting team will have a very pleasant plane ride tonight as Matt Kegel, who worked a little bit in the second quarter for Washington State, now will pick up and mop up for Jason Gesser and the Cougars. And that man, the dean of the Pac-10 coaches, Mike.
And you got to give him credit. What does he say on a recruiting trip? We got snowmobiling, we got backpacking, ice skating. You're going to love it here.
And it gets hot there in the late spring. I mean, and in the fall, too. It's a school that somehow produces, and they've had a lot of good programs up there over the year. Here's a second down play and a lot of running room. And that's for Allen Thompson, another freshman. And he's out of bounds deep inside Arizona territory.
Arizona has had a lot of yards racked up against it, both running and passing this year in the fourth quarter.
Four-12 with the ball out of bounds. We'll start mapping up the Pacific 10 scores today. Oregon over. That was Washington over California. San Jose State now being taken apart by the Sun Devils, 53-15 in the fourth quarter.
San Jose must have sent out the cheerleaders in the second half.
Yeah, they had a ball game in the first half. Allen Thompson carries again.
Washington State is going to be heard from this year. They've got too many players on this football team. This is not just an offensive explosion where they're trying to outscore the opponent. Got a very solid defense.
Single setback, second down play. Give it to Thompson again. He's knocked to the floor, and Dana Cooper checks in with us again. Dana?
Dave, Matt Kegel, who is in the game at quarterback now for Washington State, is from Haber, Montana. Now, I'm from Montana, and I can tell you there isn't much up along Haber Way. A lot of wind, a lot of snow, but they also have a good tradition of producing some quarterbacks in that region of Montana. Ryan Leaf came out on, as you recall, Great Falls Russell High School, and went on to become a Rose Bowl quarterback for the Washington State Cougars. So Matt Cagle follows his Montana predecessor to Washington State. No surprise, Matt Cagle is Ryan Leaf's cousin.
Thank you, Dana. And one can only hope that Mr. Cagle has attended some personality classes.
No,
not attended
say,
by his cousin.
I was going to say, I hope he is not in the same footsteps of Ryan Leaf.
No.
Up until the Rose Bowl, I'd say those footsteps are fine. Once you leave the Rose Bowl, those are not the footsteps you want to be in.
No, that's remarkable. It's almost in the Jeff George category.
Yeah, that ranks as one of the all-time meltdowns in athletic careers. That's right up there with Art Schleister.
All right, well, Mike Price is going to kick the field goal, and he's going to give Drew Dunning an opportunity to kick his longest of the year. He's been perfect inside 39 yards. This is now a 49-yarder, and it is up, and it is counted on the scoreboard. So a 50-yard scoreboard is this young man's best of the season. That is his second field goal tonight, eighth on the year. And the Cougars now lead it 48-21. Arizona will have it back with a minute 55 to go. We'll be right back, too. A minute 55 to go in this ballgame. And Washington State headed for a 4-0 start on the season. This young man, Mr. Holiday, has had an important part tonight. He surprised the Wildcats with a very good onside kick early on. That set the tone for the night. Gary Love on this return, and he stumped down at the 19. Well, I can almost hear the Doobie Brothers singing their hit minute by minute by minute by minute.
There he is, David. He came out of that cooler over there on the side, but he has done everything tonight. He's been the whole package, taking draws, turning them into big plays. We saw him coming out of the backfield, being able to make catches, turn it in for touchdowns. But it's been his second effort. He refuses to go down by one guy, but surprisingly, he's been able to maintain a very high energy level throughout this game.
John Rattay becomes Arizona's third quarterback on the night. And the southpaw has to scramble out, fire across the way, in and out of the hands of Gary Love.
I think we should send Dave Minnick up in Washington a tape of this game, because this is home movie stuff.
Yep.
This is the kind of stuff your mother wants to keep showing all the company and neighbors to come over.
No, you're absolutely right. And you start thinking about this guy and how he is different from the other players out there. His wife Kristen, he and she have two children, ages 5 and 3, and daddy has a different Saturday night for most college students. On second down, a little wide opening room that time. Tremaine Cox, very close to a first down. If they give it to him outside the 30, no. He's got about a yard or two to go. It'll bring up a third down for Arizona. The clock ticks with a minute and 26. Oh, what a difference a week makes. Tremaine Cox, the champagne toast to the town, with an 80-yard gallop for a touchdown against UNLV, and tonight used sparingly.
And yeah, when you're down 28 points, it definitely shakes your confidence early in the game.
Everything's different. I still think that onside kick was perhaps one of the more telling and one of the more devastating plays for Arizona tonight.
And what made that play work was the kicker was involved actually in recovering the ball. Not that he recovered it, but he kept the ball alive. Most times any team I've ever played against on the kickoff return team, as soon as the kicker kicked the ball, Dave, he wanted to run to the sideline. He wanted nothing to do with the ball. And when you can have a player that's actually going to knock the ball off the tee, get involved in the recovery, it makes a big advantage. And, you know, it wasn't all Washington State. Arizona just failed to execute on many of their early plays.
Yeah. Catch here, a catch there, a tackle here, a tackle there, and everything's different, but not tonight. 17 seconds to go. Cougars will just barely have to get onto the field. They'll set the clock in motion, and I don't believe we'll even see a play. Here is our crack production crew going to recall that big play in the first quarter. They had just scored a touchdown.
What an incredible angle. Look, we had a cameraman on the field at that time. And you can see Holiday basically just squibs that ball, just able to go 10 yards. Great touch.
One time. And even at that, there's a little trip.
I think that cameraman had been sitting on the goalpost to get that shot.
Well, John Makovic's first loss as head coach of the Wildcats. His ball club is now 3 wins and 1 loss, 0-1 in the Pac-10. His counterpart, who he will meet at midfield, Mike Price. Been a long road and a long, tough time for him in this series with the last two games. And Doug, the Wildcats now need to regroup because things don't get any easier next weekend.
And you're right, Dave, but the thing is, Arizona made more mistakes tonight than it was failure to execute. And they certainly can improve their execution, but John Makovic has to realize walking off this field that if they would have eliminated many of the mistakes they had early, this would have been a much closer ball game.
All right, a couple of high school teammates from Washington. Both teams off the field now. Well, that'll be our final score tonight. The Washington State Cougars beat the Wildcats 48-21. Now for our broadcast crew, including my colleague Doug Plank and Dana Cooper, I'm Dave Sitton saying so long for Tucson. Stay tuned for baseball tomorrow right here in WB 58, the Diamondbacks and the Dodgers. Good night, everybody.